Hello everyone and peace of Christ all of you. Today we have a special invitation. We have our sister from DCCI ministry. She's going to make a call with me. And you know, usually I don't really accept to speak out of my channel, but because they contacted me a long time ago and I said then yes, so I have to keep my promise. So they will contact me soon. I think she will be with the other brother, with her. And I think all of you, you know her. She is a speaker corner. She is a very brave woman. And, you know, they choose a topic which is about the paradise in Islam. And for me, I don't really care what the topic is. I do not need anyone to tell me what is the question. They can ask whatever they want. So if for those who like to support this ministry, DCCI ministry, they are based in England. Maybe you can even join them in some activities. They go to speaker corners in England, and they are very active people. So please invite your friends. And soon we will be with the brothers and sisters from the speaker corners. Is my voice coming good, guys? Is my voice good? Is it low? Is it high? Let me know, please. Yeah, always support the good ones. You do not need invitation, right? I mean, when you see somebody doing a good work, you know, you do not need somebody to tell you we need to support them, right? So this is, you do not need to wait for me to say, you know, this is the right thing to do. You know better than me. So, you know, the whole purpose of what we do is sharing knowledge and to arm Christians with the questions, answers and questions which no Muslim can answer. So Muslims, they have questions for us and somebody have to answer them. And not only Muslims, I mean atheists, etc. So we as a Christians, we cannot just be just Christian by name and say, okay, I have a faith and I don't care what people are asking for. You can do that, but I mean, you have a duty in this life is to save people, not only just to be selfish and to be saved yourself. So we have always a duty, and if we don't practice our duty, then we are not really being Christians. All right? And always, by the way, like, you know, there is a... always I say to my admins, if a Muslim want to debate me, please verify that he is a real person, and which mean, I say always, I want a scholar, a sheikh, a big shot. And then my admins, they send me a link of a guy, a kid who created this chat. They are not listening. When we ask for Facebook, we do not want Facebook. This is not the point. Otherwise, he can create a... We wanted to verify who is this person. Is he worth it? Not a guy, he created Facebook and you send me his Facebook, says this is the guy I want to debate you. All right? So if you want to bring me someone, he have a Facebook, we check his page to see maybe he's a sheikh, he's a sheikhi, he's a belly dancer. Who is he? Not a guy, he just opened a Facebook 2 hours ago and he sent you a link. What I will do with the link? My voice is cutting out. Okay, let me switch my my internet. So and that make it kind of hard. Okay, what about now? Is it better now? Okay. Well, I hope it's going to be good now. Let us see here. All right. And you know, Muslims, they when they defend Islam, they have the right to defend Islam, no problem. But our duty here is to show that Muslims, when they defend Islam, they prove Islam to be false. I never saw a Muslim really is smart to debate Islam or to prove Islam to be correct. The Muslims, they take advantage of you, of not knowing, and this is the only chance they have. They can make a point against you. Like, let us make it simple. If you're an ignorant, anyone can beat you up. You know what I mean? When you are an ignorant, anyone can beat you up. So it's not really about Islam is good or not. Anyone. A person who worships a tree, he can beat you up if you are an ignorant. So this is what the Bible says, is that, you know, my people be destroyed because of their ignorance. So when you are having an ignorance, you have a big problem. It's like, you know, you are sick. And we need to fight ignorance. This is the problem. The whole world is suffering from that. People die because of disease. What disease is? Disease that us, we are ignorant about how to fight it. You know, not long time ago, people used to die by flu by millions. Almost the whole earth was demolished by flu. It's just a stupid flu. But because we do not know how to fight this very simple, tiny virus, people die by millions. Ignorance. Today, flu is not a big problem. And Islam is no better, no different. So you need to learn about, you know, your weakness, your ignorance. And again, if there is any Muslim want to debate me, you are more than welcome. But I don't want to debate kids, because we cannot call it a debate. Or Muslims calling me, like this guy in the text, his name is Fahim. Do you see this guy, Fahim? If you click at his page, you will see a guy, he is like 55 years old. Last time he called me, he played for me a love song. You believe it? I mean, if you click at this guy image, he is maybe 55, 60 years old. And he called me, he played for me love songs. So we don't want to waste our time with kids. So when we say a Muslim want to debate me, give us your Facebook to verify, not that you have a Facebook, as some of our my admins, they think, like I'm asking for a Facebook. I'm not asking for a Facebook. Facebook is just a way to see who is he. Not a guy who made a Facebook 2 hours ago and you sent him to me. We need to be sure that this guy, he claimed to be a big shot. Like he is Zach and Naik. He is Shish Kebab. He is Shabir Ali. You know, not a kid. If he made the Facebook 2 hours ago and you posted for me. So we don't want to waste our time with those, you know, idiots. Otherwise, all Muslims are welcome to prove Islam to us. All of the Muslims. But I don't want to waste your time. Explain 48:9. Okay. There is nothing out of the topic, you know. But because today we are like a guest, I don't control the topic. I don't know what they will talk about. We will see. Their title says paradise. So I don't know. We will see. Your Facebook last day upload about 92 ministers sentenced to death by Islam Afghanistan. I did not post anything in my Facebook, Mr. August. If people deposit there, that's not me. It's not me who posted about Afghanistan. I never posted about Afghanistan. Yeah, the storm yesterday passed, you know, and later I found out that this storm happened because Shaitan, he heard the prayer of Allah. If you remember, the Prophet Muhammad, peace upon him, he said when Shaitan, he heard the prayer of the Muslims, he fought. And looked like there was a lot of Muslims yesterday were praying very hard, and Shaitan was farting left and right and right. So I was like, I wasn't sure really why the wind is so strong, and the wind like smelled something fishy about it, and it sounded like a thunder, to be honest with you, but it turned to be not a thunder, to be the fart of Shaitan. And here we go, the hate in front of you. And for sure, the Prophet, he never lie. The Prophet, he never lie. Yeah. Proving to be true, by the way. It's a true story. Anyway, guys, invite your friends. We are waiting for the team from the speaker corner to call me, and we will go from there. And don't invite me to speak on your channel, please, because I, as I said, I don't like interview style, and I told them already, don't interview me, don't ask me questions about myself. I am no one. Did you watch the movie? It's called I Am, My Name Is Nobody. Abundant love, Arabian prophet, he lied, he says the earth is flat. Me said, I said that. Hello?
Hello, peace of Christ be with you, sir. How are you?
Hey, sister, peace of Christ with you.
So, you are on our live stream.
All right.
I'm just going to ask you a very practical question. Are you okay to be recorded in this live stream?
Oh, for sure.
Because we do have lots of issues with YouTube. People who comes on live stream complains about their privacy. So therefore, I am asking you if you are okay to be recorded.
Well, why somebody want to come in live stream, but he don't want anyone to hear him? I mean,
I know. No, they want to be heard, but in somehow towards end, soon after our video finishes, YouTube sends a message to say, you recorded the people who didn't want to be recorded.
Yeah,
so
therefore,
I am asking.
You can record me 24 hours, 7 days a week. No problem.
How are you, sir?
I'm fine. Don't call me sir. Why you call me sir?
I don't know you that much.
Yeah, this is the first time, actually. This is the first time we talk. You know, you text me before, but we never talked before. I mean,
yes. Yeah. I don't know your favorite color. Do you have favorite color?
I like the color which Prophet Muhammad he like only.
Green?
No, Prophet Muhammad, he like red.
Okay.
I'm just joking.
Okay. I am disappointed to hear that you are taking Muhammad as an example.
No, I'm not taking him as an example. I'm just joking. I know.
All right. So I'm just trying to share you on my live stream. So.
All right.
Christian friends. So plan is for tonight is overall just talk about Islamic paradise and what Islamic paradise offers to Muslim men. Are you okay with the topic?
Sure, anything. You do not need to tell me what the topic. Just ask me the question. What do you want?
You are not as kind as me.
Yeah, anything you want. Just ask me whatever you want, and I will be happy to answer.
Okay. So, I read your books, I think it was last year, on sex and Allah.
Mm-hmm.
I must say it was sadly very funny, but it was sad because life of Islam looks very funny, yet it is sad.
Yeah.
So, why did you write those two books?
People needed, I always do what people ask me for. So I noticed that people, they are asking for some reference in their hand, and this is a book specific, like the specialty about it. It's about sexuality in Islam. So anyone want to do research, even if you want to do academic search, he will find a great reference about this topic in such two books. So now you do not need to go through tons of books to find some restaurant, like some reference. So, you know, I made them easy, and I did not put everything there. I put what is enough to prove a point.
So I've done something very practical. I am not Arabic speaker. I am from Turkey.
All right.
And I went to mosque, and I took your book with me. I think it was volume one.
All right.
And I wanted Imam from the mosque to just tell me what was happening in one of the hadith. Mm-hmm. It is the hadith when wife is beaten, her skin is greener than her dress, and Muhammad says you need to
taste her. Yeah. You have to taste his juice. Yeah
So I took that to a mosque. And Imam told me actually that's not in hadith,
really.
And then I was asking, are you sure? And then he said, no, it's not in hadith. I found the Arabic version hadith, and I took the physical copy to Imam. And he started telling me, actually, that is wrong translation.
Okay, what is the correct translation?
So correct translation was actually supposed to be if just the marriage, not the zavaj. Word is zavaj.
What zavaj?
So he told me there are two words in Arabic. One of them is nikah, other one is zavaj. Mm-hmm. And he told me the word which is in that hadith is zavaj.
What is the word he says it is zavaj? What is the word he's saying?
Marriage. It needs to be marriage. So he's just simply saying, go and marry with this guy to go back to your first husband.
Well, we can go right now and we can read the hadith. Let us go there. And I will use the Muslim translation.
Yeah.
So they will not say, you know, he is using his own translation, right? I mean, there's no excuse after that. This is the hadith I'm going to share. I can send you the link actually in Skype. I don't know if you can open it there. Let me share it with you.
Okay, I'm not very good with technology, so you need
no
to
problem.
Be.
No problem. I will read it. I will read
it. Time to me.
Yeah, it's okay. Don't worry. It says here, Rifa divorced his wife, whereupon Abu Abdurrahman, etc., married her. So there's a guy, he divorced a woman. His name is Rifa. The other guy, his name Abu Abdurrahman, he married her. One day this woman, she came to her to Aisha, as she complained that her husband did beat her until he made her skin greener than her clothes. And then Muhammad, he came and he asked what's happening. So she said to him the story that her husband did beat her. Then Abu Abdurrahman, he heard that she went to Muhammad. So he came and he found his wife, she went to Muhammad. So he came with his two sons from the another wife. So this is two sons he have from different wife. And then she said, which means the wife, by Allah, I have done nothing wrong to him, but he is impotent and he is useless as this to me, holding her fabric, which means this guy, he cannot have sex. Holding, showing the fringe of her garment. Abu Abdurrahman said, by Allah, I can satisfy her, but she is disobedient and wants to go back to Rifa. Allah messenger said to her, if this is your intention, then you know that it is unlawful for you this is the Muslim translation, not my translation, to remarry Rifa, unless Abu Abdurrahman had sexual intercourse with you. Then the Prophet said, he saw the two boys of the Abdurrahman and he asked him, are these your sons? Abu Abdurrahman said, yes. The Prophet said, you claim what you claim, which means the guy, he cannot have sex. But Allah, by Allah, those boys resemble him as they resemble the crow. So this is one of the hadith about the story.
Yeah, so what Imam told me was, where it says Abdurrahman has had sexual intercourse with you, that means actually when he marries.
No, actually, actually in Arabic it does not say,
I know,
sexual intercourse. In Arabic it says until he tastes her juice.
Yeah.
It says حتى يذوق عسيلتك. And anyone who speaks Arabic, you can see in my screen here. So we are not lying. That's what it says. It did not even mention the word intercourse. It says until you taste, he tastes your juice. Now we can go right now to the Arabic dictionary, Arabic English dictionary. And we see what the word asila.
Yeah, so that's what I did. I went to, I took the picture of Arabic dictionary, and then I show it to Imam. But Imam was like still shouting and screaming at me. I think he thought that was like speaker's corner. Mm-hmm. He was shouting and screaming at me to tell me why I am making Muhammad look bad.
Yeah, this is the only way to run away from the. Yeah, here we go. I put it in the screen. And then the ones who can see my screen, I just search for the word asila. This is Islamic website, not my website. This is the word asila, and it says asila mean orgasm, as simple as that. So the prophet says he did not say until you have intercourse. He said until he tests your orgasm.
Okay, that was a polite way to put it together. Anyway, so if anyone hasn't read the books, guys, read the books, memorize them, take them to mosque, challenge the imams, challenge the Muslims. It's very funny because some of the things they never read it, and when they read it, in somehow it just makes them.
Did you see what is written in the cover?
Sex and Allah.
Yeah, in the cover, and the verse in the cover.
Oh, yeah, that's the 5566.
Yeah.
Restain whom? Yeah. Do you want me to read it? My English is very bad.
I mean, this is alone is a disaster. What kind of religion? What kind of religion does God, he describe what is inside the women private part, you know, to make us believe in it?
You don't need to be a genius to answer that question. It's called Allah.
Yeah.
But that's a different topic.
Yeah.
Anyway, just wanted to say thank you very much for these works. They are very, very helpful to Christians. Also, it is very helpful for Muslims who never even bother to think about what their religion is teaching. But as I've been harassing you for a long time now, I want you to kind of just tell us a little bit about what does Islamic paradise is offering to Muslim men when it comes to men or when it comes to boys.
You see, first of all, if we ask ourselves what is the word paradise is coming from in Islam? I mean, the God of Islam, obviously he is not God, because he mixed between what is heaven and what is a garden. As an example, if we go to the Quran and try to find the God of Islam is speaking about heaven, suddenly we will find that Allah, he speak about the Garden of Eden. Garden of Eden. And that is all over the Quran. Chapter 9, 72, chapter 13, 23, chapter 16, 31, 18, 31, 19, 61, 35, 33, 38, 50, 48, 61 to 12 98 8. So all of this is speaking about the Garden of Eden. But how the Garden of Eden end to be in the heaven of Allah? This is showing us that the one who wrote the Quran, not only he is an idiot, he is ignorant, because the Garden of Eden is not supposed to be in the sky. But in Islam, suddenly the Garden of Eden is jumping to be in the sky. And here, if you look at the heaven, as an example, in chapter 18, verse number 31, you will see how silly this heaven. I know you want to know about the boys, but we want to give introduction to those people who they are trying to understand. If you go to that verse in 18:31, you will see it's speaking about that Allah will give me a bracelet of gold, and I will wear a green silk clothes for eternity. and I will be laying down in a couch, and I will have a pillow underneath of me.
Okay, so if just a moment, green is not your favorite color, so your favorite color is red. What are you gonna do?
None of those actually is my favorite color anyway, but I'm just joking with you. But in here,
like, speak of the argument.
You see, this is the good thing about women. You know, like, women, they want to know what the color you like. This is not my topic. Focus with me in the heaven. So the heaven is of Islam. It is very silly. Very silly. What kind of God he promised me a bracelet in my hand? And I am a man. Why a man when I wear a bracelet? A bracelet of gold. And then I will wear a green silk clothes all my life for eternity. How boring. And not on, and he is trying to tempt me, and he say you will be reclining there. I mean, how silly is that? So what does that mean? I mean, this is, so here you notice that Muhammad is making fun of us, insulting our intelligence, believing that we are a bunch of fools, and we will believe in such a religion because he promised us a couch, and he promised us a green silk and a bracelet in our hand, and we will have open buffet. Now, if you go to the boys in the heaven, or let us say what Muslims they call them ghulman. First of all, the word ghulman, or I don't know if you know what ghulman mean. What ghulman mean according to your knowledge? Do you know?
I don't know, but can I make a comment before you move to that on Surah 18, verse 31?
Go ahead.
So my understanding was, of course, I'm not expert. My understanding was, Islamic paradise is where men are gonna meet with all their desires.
Yes.
Okay. And I haven't met that many men, but I come across only few men who would be happy with green. So if their desire is not green, do you think they have right to ask Allah if they can change the color?
No, that's it. You know, this, your heaven is fixed. This is what is the heaven. The food you eat, the clothes you wear, it's not up to you. That's it. Even in the heaven of Allah, there is only one kind of meat, which is bird meat. You know, that's it. There's no fish. There's no shrimp. There is no beef. That's it. There's only bird meat. That's it.
So I have to be like kind of different type of vegan in heaven, in Islamic paradise.
Yeah, everything is fixed. Everything is already prefixed. Your clothes, your dress, your etc. And the color is not, you know. And the funny thing, Muhammad, he says whatever they wish, whatever they wish. But yet he is telling us exactly what we will wear. You know, what is the wish in the story? When you say to somebody whatever you wish, it's mean whatever you wish. So why you say to him you will wear a green silk? What if I don't want like a green? A green, you will be like in a surgery room, a bunch of surgeons in the hospital, you know, working in your body. Everybody is wearing green, you know.
What about silk? Because there are people who are allergic to silk.
Actually, he did not say the word silk. You see the translation in there, it says silk, but the fact it is silk, but it's not really silk as just silk. It is it's like Gucci, you know. The word in Arabic there is istabraqa. Istabraqa, which is a fabric made in Iran, and this fabric, you know, it's very famous. Let us see here. It's very famous. Let us show you on the screen.
I need to make a comment on it.
All right. So the it's a fabric. It's like now you say Gucci, you know. So in the time of Muhammad, if you go to chapter 55, verse number 54, it says that Allah will provide them with couches lined with silk brocade, and this is the same kind of clothes they will wear. So this is a Gucci at the time of Muhammad. Like, there was a very famous name of a fabric made in Persia. Muhammad promising his followers, you will get that, which like saying today, you will get Gucci. So obviously, this is proving to us that Muhammad is a false prophet again. Because imagine, God, he promised me Gucci. This is literally, imagine I say to you in a book now, I am a prophet, and my God will give you Gucci. He named it as Gucci. He did not just say, he did not say silk. He said istabraqa. Istabraq is a Gucci at that time as a brand, of a fabric made in Iran.
Okay. So what does it say to you about Sunni Muslims? Because Iran is a country where Shia Muslims based.
Yeah, no, but so, this has nothing to do with Shia and Sunni.
I know, but now Shia is took over. So if Muhammad is pointing them, remember Muhammad is like, knows everything, he's a very good guy. He's pointing people to Iran. Maybe there is a something no, we can think.
I believe Muhammad, who worked in trade when he was working for his wife, he knew about this fabric, which is very expensive, and only rich people, they can wear it. So Muhammad, he promised his followers that they will wear, they will in the heaven, Allah promised them Gucci. So it's not about the Persian as much, it's about promising them the most or the best he have in his time. People heard about it.
I know, I was trying to make a joke, but yeah, that didn't go well.
Yeah, it's okay. Anyway, don't worry.
So, okay, sorry, I had to stop you there. You were gonna go through the boys. Right. I'm asking this because, so I have brothers, lots of Christian brothers, and they do, they are asked a lot to convert to Islam. I'm just like trying to find good reasons why a Christian man should not convert to Islam, because it is attractive to have 72 virgins and you can do whatever you want to do, but there are also some negative side of being man in paradise. Therefore, that's why I'm asking this question to you.
You know, first of all, if somebody want to convert to a religion because of sex, I mean, go and convert to Las Vegas, and go and convert to go to San Francisco.
No, go, Las Vegas is expensive, though. I checked the tickets like a couple
months back. No, the Islam is expensive too. You will spend your life bending upside down, and you wake up early in the morning, and you bend down, and then you have to do Hajj, and you have to, you might die there. People step on you. 5,000 people last time they were killed. You get diseases, you get all kind of viruses, people kissing the black stone, licking the black stone, all the bacteria and the virus in the world, they come with it. And then you drink the water of Zamzam, which is full of arsenic, which is poisoned. And then you go back home and here we go, bingo, you are dead. If you survive the Hajj. Now, on the top of that, you spend a lot of money to make Allah happy. It's not for free. Allah will not pay for your ticket. So you have to fly all the way to the Kaaba, even if you are an Indian guy who cannot even pay for your child support. You know, a person who is in India, his income for the whole year is not even $1,000. He have to save at least $7,000 to $8,000 to go and do Hajj. And then in Hajj, either he die or he will be robbed or he will get viruses or people, they walk in the top of him, especially when they go around the house of the shaitan. And by the way, shaitan, he moved to Australia. He's not there no more. So what the point of this, you know, it's not for free. It's just a false promise and a stupid promise. Otherwise, anyone can make a promise. I can make a promise now. If you believe in me, I will give you a heaven. What do you like, shrimp? Full of shrimp. You know, I will give a promise to everyone fit with his what he like. You know, I can make a better deal than Muhammad deal. People like sex. Okay, a lot of sex, as much as you wish. What do you like? Like art? I will give you a better than Muhammad deal, because Muhammad, he forbid art, forbid drawing. In the heaven of Allah, I will give you unlimited paint supply to paint for the rest of your life. So if about promises, if I am a fool and anyone he make a promise for me, I will believe it. That means he is a fool, and the fool, nobody can stop him from converting to foolishness. Go and convert, who care? But the question is, if Allah is a true God, why he need to promise me such a silly, stupid promise? Because this is silly and this is stupid and this is not even a human. We are not a bunch of animals. We are just made. We are made to be sex toys. Same time, what is the point of having sex? Like Muhammad, he speak about 70 years orgasm. So what the difference between 70 years orgasm or 7 minutes? Why it have to be 70 years? What about to make it 700 years? Maybe it's better, 700 years. So obviously, the promise is foolish, and only foolish can believe in such a promise. And if somebody want to be foolish, go and believe in whatever foolishness you want.
So 1.84 billion Muslims are willing to make a bargain, getting all those 72 virgins, all those like sex, all those kind of things, versus in somehow they don't want to make a bargain on the good things you are offering them.
Well, trust me,
a lot about mind of Islam.
Sister, the 1.4 billion Muslims, none of them believe in Islam. If they do, they will do jihad. And this is why they are not doing jihad. Because simply if they believe in Islam, because the one who do jihad, he will get better versions and he will get higher rank. So obviously, none of them believing in this garbage, and none of them want to get the ranks which is higher, because it's the heaven of Allah is 100th floor, and every floor have different rank and different reward. So when you go in the heaven of Allah, if you are a person who did jihad and die for the sake of Allah, Allah will give you a lot better women. But if you are a person who just a Muslim, the lowest heaven, the lowest reward for a Muslim in heaven is 300 boys and 72. This is the lowest.
Yeah. So, that's where I step in. Sorry, that's where my question starts.
Okay.
So, Muslim man wants to follow Islam as faithfully as they can, and they want to take the life of non-Muslims in name of Allah, and they end up in this Las Vegas where they are going to get 72 virgins alongside of 300 boys. What are those boys are going to do in paradise?
Yeah, first of all, they are not boys.
So what are those 300?
The word ghulman is coming from the word ghulma. Ghulma is somebody, I don't know what the equal word in English, let me see in the translation, hold on. If somebody, he is an age where he is like a youth, but he is so excited for sex, that is what is ghulma mean. If we go here, here we go. This is the word ghulma. This is the word ghulma. This is Islamic dictionary, not my dictionary. This is the word ghulma, where the word ghulam coming from. It says here, oh, this is all the description for the word ghulma. So those ghulman, they are boiling for appetite of sex, sexual desire. So Muhammad is not only promising them that you will have, like here they say, nephomia. I don't know if I'm saying it correctly. Nephomia, nephomonia. I don't know what to say it. So
English is not my expertise.
It's okay, but the people, they can see my screen, they can read it. But anyway, this is where the word ghulma is coming from, the word ghulam. So Muhammad is promising them ghulman, not boys, not just boys. They are not, because when you say boys in English, it means maybe he's like 6 years older. You know, this is not what it says. They are ghulman who they are facing, or let us say, they are in a stage of their sexuality is in the top. The sexual desire and needs is the top human being he can have. So at that age, this is what Muhammad is offering in heaven. Now, why Muhammad is promising them such a person, or such a, if we can call him a young youth, you know, like teenage, who is so horny. What is the point if he is just going to be a servant? There's other hadith where Muhammad, he says,
sorry, you've got 300 of those boys. I'll call them boys because I can't pronounce that Arabic word. And also those of, if anyone is eating, it will make
the number is not really 300. There's a hadith say 300. There's a hadith says 80,000 boys
in the first floor of paradise.
Yes, this is for the bad Muslim, not for the good Muslim.
Okay.
If you go to Jami al-Tirmidhi, you know, Jami al-Tirmidhi, hadith number 2562, it says, sorry, the least of the people of paradise in possession is the one with 80,000, you know, servant, which they are the ghulman, and 72 wives. He shall have a tent of made of pearl, etc. And then he described the rest of the, like the accessories. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. maybe it's my English or maybe it's my maths. Something is not matching up. So you have one man, okay? He's got 72 virgin wives and up to 80,000 boys.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so he's gonna have sex with them, with 72 people each day. Okay. So one day is 24 hours divided 72. Not very good number. And of course, between the times, I don't know, probably like there needs to be rest, there needs to be food being eaten, plus you've got those boys who are in their top level of their sexual desire. Is it my maths is not matching here, or there is like something else going?
No, here actually there's a lot of stupid promises Muhammad he made. Because remember, we just mentioned that Muhammad, he promised the Muslim he would have an orgasm of 70 years. So okay, that's me. What the benefit of having those 72, if your orgasm will be 70 years? That's mean in order to, I mean, if the orgasm is the short time compared to the sex time. So let us say if the orgasm is 1% of the sexual relation time. So that means the sexual relation time is going to be what? 500 years? So by the time you finish with the first one, it's going to be maybe 500 years or 570 years. And then you start with the second one. So in order to finish the 72, maybe it's going to take him maybe 35,000 years.
So,
you know what I mean? I mean, because the number
hospital, is there a hospital in Islamic paradise? Because I am assuming man will need hospital or woman will need hospital.
So 72 years orgasm. This is just the orgasm. The orgasm is a short period compared to the sexual period. So if Muhammad is saying it is 70 years, then we have to think about, so how long the sex will be? Well, it's going to be 2 minutes? No way. It's going to be 5 minutes? No way. It would be funny if sex is 5 minutes and the orgasm is 70 years. So if the orgasm is 70 years, the whole process is how long? You know what I mean?
Anyway, it, like, as a Christian woman, it makes me feel sick. But I don't know how does it make feel Muslim woman, because there was I spoke to a Muslim woman once. She was okay with it.
You know what the Muslim will say to you? I mean, he is that's it. This is his religion. This is his stupid cult. He will change it. He cannot. So he will say it's good. I mean, I'm happy with it. But the fact, I'm sure many of them, they have a lot of questions in their head. I mean, what's wrong with this God? What, you know, why sex occupies so much of the head of Allah? He cannot make us happy in different way. I mean, God is almighty and he can make you happy. Happiness is not difficult for God to bring it to you. So if happiness became just sex, then this God must be a sexual God, because he concentrate, if we go and read in the Quran, The only promises is either about gold, silver, clothes, food, and sex. And sex will take a big portion of this heaven. So everything is about the belly and down. There's no heart. There's no love. There's no, you know, what about God created Adam and Eve? So the logic is, if God will provide us with sexuality, then, well, one man and one woman, because God, he did not create Adam and 72 Eves or 72,000 Eves. So if this is what God he did in the beginning, why he would do different in the end? It doesn't make sense. So Muhammad, he was trying to tempt his men to die for him, go and fight and die, and the promises is so cheap. I mean, talk is cheap. I can promise you heaven as you wish. I can promise you the biggest. Even Muhammad, he promised a guy that he will have a corner lot in heaven, and he in exchange of his palm tree farm. So Muhammad, obviously, he is a good bargain person. Actually, even the Quran describe Islam as a bargain, as a business. Muhammad, he says, shall I, his God told him, supposedly, shall I lead you to a bargain, a business, you know, which will bring you to Allah and get a great reward? It's a bargain, you know. So why Allah, he consider believing in him as a business, unless he is doing a business? Muhammad is a businessman, and he is saying to them, Allah is a business too. You believe in him? Here we go. Read chapter 61, verse number 10. Oh, who you believe, shall I show you a commerce that you will save you from painful doom? It's a business. It's a trade. You give Allah this, he give you Allah that in return.
So let me go back to my Christian brothers who might think it's good offer to buy Islamic paradise or get the Islamic paradise. And some of those brothers are married. Okay. So let's say they end up in Islamic paradise. What are their wives going to get it? If sake of the argument, their wives made it to the paradise. Are they going to get 72 virgin men? Because equality is important, you know?
Well, there is many hadith, Muhammad, he mentioned. And remember, always, anytime the Muslims, they find something embarrassing, they will say it's da'if. Anything is, but da'if is accepted still. So if
they all pass the test.
Yeah, if we go in the hadith, in Jami' al-Tirmidhi, it says, indeed, in paradise, there is a market which there is no buying nor selling except for images of men and women. So whenever a man desire an image, he entered. What does that mean? This is the Playboy magazine of Allah. So now, in the heaven of Allah, the heaven, the sexuality is not a sexuality about man sleeping with women only. It is a magazine. There's a magazine store, big mall. There's nothing there. There's no fruits. There's no vegetables. There's no clothes. Only images, pictures, Playboy. And then the customer is a man. There's no women customer there. So the sellers, the one who is going to buy, is a man. And if the man desire an image, he enter it, which means he will have sex with it. But the images are images of what? Images of men and women. So Islam clearly speak about homosexuality in the heaven of Allah, and it's widely promoted, and they have no problem with it. Actually, I have a video, I don't know if you heard it before, where a guy, many of them actually, they speak about sex in Islam, and the person, he said, there's no problem. What's your problem? You know, yes, in heaven there is no sin. A man, he can even have, I ask him, so you can have sex with your mother? He said, so what? Why you don't understand? There's no sin in heaven.
I do get as well.
Sorry?
Oh, is that my, I can hear my voice back. I do hear that a lot as well. Muslim men don't see there is any issue that they might have sex with their sisters or with their mothers, even if with their grandmothers.
Yeah, because simply heaven in Islam is nothing but it's a hippie house, you know, like the hippie revolution in the 60s, where you know, European people, they decide to go wild and they want to just have a free sex as they wish, anytime they wish, in the beach. There's no need for marriage, you know, we can share men and women. So Islam is very much advanced before that. But the reason for Islam to be like that, as long as you have my book, if you go in the first volume, you will see the Arab, they used to have many kind of marriages, correct?
Yeah.
Many. And many of those marriages based in exchanging women. Exchanging women. So Muhammad, he understand that pleasure, because I believe strongly that Muhammad himself, he used to exchange women. This is why in the Quran, it says, like if you go in the Quran chapter of Al-Ahzab, where Muhammad, Allah, he says, supposedly Allah said to Muhammad, not Muhammad saying it to himself, that any woman, she want to give herself to the Prophet so he can have sex with her. And then Muhammad, after that, in verse number 52, it says, it's not allowed for you to change or exchange. This is the translation the Muslims they have. So how you can exchange women? I mean, how you can change a woman? You see, here it did not say divorce. He says you cannot change or exchange. Exchange in Arabic, to beddel, to beddel. There's a huge difference between divorce and change. Divorce, she's gone.
You know? I'm not that much surprised on that, because isn't it the same God who tells when husband doesn't need his wife anymore, you can marry him. So in the mind of Allah, human beings are an object which you just buy it from the shop and you can turn it and take it back.
Yeah, but here the idea is why the Quran saying to Muhammad, you cannot change or exchange. But here, like this is Yusuf Ali, I will read it for the Muslims, and I'm not using my translation. It is not lawful for thee, between two brackets, to marry more women after this, nor to change them for other wives. How you can do change other way? You see, it's not allowed for you to marry more women, nor to change them for other wives. What was happening here, obviously, that Muhammad at that time and the Muslims, they are practicing a changing wives. And changing wives is not a divorce. Changing wives is you take my wife, I take yours for a period of time. And this is what the Arab used to do before that. So Muhammad, obviously, he still enjoy changing wives, the same as the Arab used to do so. This is why when a Bedouin man, he came to Muhammad and he said to him, give me al-Humayra, you know, the Aisha, they call him the blondie. So Muhammad, he said, but she is the mother of the believers. Muhammad, he did not take his sword to fight him, and I am the prophet, I will kill you. No, he was, it's okay. And then Aisha, she said to him, who is this guy who can say such a thing to you? Muhammad, he said, he is a fool, we have to obey. Which means if he insists to take you, he will, and I will give you to him. So sexuality in Islam is beyond just it's not just like heaven and even in earth. I mean, is earth is different from heaven in Islam? All of it is about sex.
Let me ask you a question. I'm guessing you've been Christian long enough. How old are you? Are you like in your 30s, 40s, 80s?
I'm very old, even
okay. I'll think you are in your 70s.
Yeah, 80, 90, can say.
Yeah, I'll go with 70s.
Okay.
For last 70 years, right. How does it make you feel as you read these verses as man and hearing Allah does give you right to exchange your wife with someone else's wife?
Well, first of all, here you see always the story have two sides. There's the guy who will take the wife, and there's the guy who will lose the wife. So Muhammad always the one who will take the wife. You see, remember the story where Muhammad, he took the wife of his own son, right?
Yeah.
So in the story, Zayd, he is younger than Muhammad, and Muhammad is the old guy, but yet the younger is the loser, and the older is the winner. So Zayd, he been forced to divorce his wife, so Muhammad, he can have her. So age will not change the fact that everything in Islam is about a winner and a loser, and always Muhammad have to be the winner when it's come to sex. You, even if you are the son of Muhammad, you are not safe. Your wife is not safe from him. And even Ibn al-Arabi, in the interpretation, they says that Ibn al-Arabi, he said, if the prophet, his eyes fall into a woman, her husband, he must divorce her immediately so the prophet, he can have her. So Muhammad, I believe, in certain point, his reputation became so horrible, and he wanted to fix it to make it look like, okay, you know what? I became a good guy. I'm not going to exchange wives no more. I'm not going to be the playboy. You know me anymore. So in the chat of Al-Ahzab, after he made the chat, the verse where it says that any Muslim woman, she can give herself to the Prophet so he can have sex with her. After that, Muhammad, he came. Oh, okay, you know what Allah, he told me, after that I cannot change women. Because people, they start talking about what kind of a prophet this prophet is. And that's why, if you remember, Aisha, she said to Muhammad, "Inni ara rabbuka yusari'u ila hawaka ya Muhammad." I see that your God, he rush into your desire, Muhammad, sexual desire. Now, why Aisha, she said that? She is the wife of the prophet. She is not a stranger. But if Aisha, she is not stupid. She is observing, and she learned that her husband is a sexual predator, and he will use God as a puppet for his sexual desire. So women, they start offering themselves to the prophet to sleep with him. And Aisha, she said, "I felt jealous of the women who offered themselves to Allah Messenger," and said, "Then when Allah, the Exalted, the Glorious, revealed this, you may differ between any of them as you wish, and take to yourself any you wish, and if you desire any of you have set aside, no sin chargeable for you." So Aisha here, she noticed, oh, not only he made verses that a woman, she can give herself, but now Muhammad, he make other verses saying that if a woman, she don't look good for Muhammad, he don't like to sleep with her, Allah gave him, or he make a verse, obviously, saying, oh, the one I don't like, I can't say, oh, stay aside. The one I like will come to the bedroom. So Aisha, she said, "It seemed to me that your Lord hastened to satisfy your desire."
So, in simpler way, it makes you feel double sick.
In simple way, it make me feel that you know, Satan is exist. You know, because this is what Satan do. You know, I will not make the Satan make me sick, because I know he is what he is. But this is a proof that Satan is there, because you see, a person who claimed to be a prophet of God, and then he tried to take advantage of his followers, specifically women. Obviously, he is a cult leader. All cult leaders in the world, they share one thing. They are sexual predators. They are going after their followers. So, you believe in me, I'm going to sleep with you if you believe in me. And this is exactly what Muhammad did. If Muhammad was a good person, and he is a prophet of God, and the Muslims, they say he is the most decent, good man, then why he needed, he have already 13 wives. So why he needed verses saying, any woman she can give herself to the prophet? Why? He is short of women. He is short of sex. He cannot find a wife. He have 13 already, and he have many sex slaves. You know, and even his wives, they get him busted having sex with Mary the Copt in their bed. So why he needed all those women?
Okay, so Muhammad had lots of wives, he had sex slaves, but still he need extra people to meet up with his sexual desire. And he's offering that sexual desire for his followers when they get to paradise. Go back to those boys in paradise. I'm really curious about what are those boys are going to do in paradise.
Well, the Muslims, they say that those boys are going just to serve us. But
what are going to serve with their, like, all high, I don't know what is the term for that, high level of their ready to have sex desire? I don't know what is the term
Let us analyze what the Muslims, they will say to us first. The Muslims, they will say, no, they will not have sex with them. They will just serve you. Okay. Now, there's a video on YouTube published by the Dean Show, and the guy who speak there, his name is Dr. Dermelli. I forgot his first name. People, they can search for it. It's called The Description of Paradise. And he says, in the heaven, if you wish something, it's going to be in front of you right away, which means not the servant will bring it to you. Like if you see a bird in the sky, you say Subhanallah, and the bird will be cooked in a dish in front of you. When you finish eat, there's no dirt; it's gone.
So why do you need servants then?
This is the question then. So why? What servant will do? And imagine not only that, in the heaven of Allah, your clothes will never go wrinkles, and you will never take a shower, and there's no dirt, and there's no dust, and there's no cleaning, and there's no sweat, and even there's no sperm in some stories they say. So what the servants are for, what they will do? This is the question the Muslims cannot answer. The Quran says that those servants, they will go around them serving them, and they have cup of wine, and then it says la yanzifun, and they will not bleed. Now the Muslim, they say the word bleeding there is about not about bleeding from like using blood, it's about getting drunk. But why the boys will get drunk? It is the masters who will drink, not the boys. You know?
So in today's society, servants wouldn't sit down and then eat with their master. I am assuming in Islamic paradise where man doesn't need anything, like they don't even need servant, still they do get those boys.
You see, if you watch this video, I encourage people to watch it so they can laugh. The guy, he said, you will have 80,000 boys serving you. Now, 80,000 boys
to one man,
and yeah, for one man only. And then this man, he, if he wished something, is going to be in front of him before even he says. So what the boy would do? It is silly, it is stupid, and the Muslims, they try to get away with this promises. At the same time, isn't it, this is a child abuse? Let us say they are youth.
But slavery is all right though in Islam.
It's all right, yeah. But
yeah, so
but those who claim that Islam is a good religion and Islam is have ethic. I mean, where is the ethic in this? Allah will enslave for eternity a bunch of youth, and their job is to serve me a cup of wine for eternity. If they will not have sex, according to Muslims, let us say I'm going to the Muslims' claim. Let us say they will not have sex with them, they will just serve us wine. So is it right to enslave 80,000 little youth just to serve me wine? 80,000, how many cup of wine I will drink a day? I mean, why 80,000?
Sorry, my brain sometimes just, most of times doesn't work. So you've got those 80,000 boys who are high in their sexual desire, okay? And all of their job is to just serve you wines, 80,000 wines in one go. That's a lot of wine. That's a lot of kids, a lot of boys. And I am very curious why Muhammad needed to express how high was their sexual desire. Well, what do you think?
Well, you know, it's not only a lot of wine. I mean, this is stupid. I mean, what you see, like, if heaven is heaven, can't heaven be perfect without having a youth next to my bed? 80,000. I mean, 80,000, they have to be mute to enjoy my day. 80,000, they don't talk. 80,000, they don't blink. 80,000, they don't even make a sound when they walk. Because if you have 80,000 chicken and they walk around without talking, without making buck, 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 they will drive you crazy by the sound of their feet. So you have 80,000 youth. This is an army. You can fight, and you can, you know, there's some countries until now, they don't have 80,000 soldiers. So 80,000 just to serve me wine.
Well, life must be very hard in paradise, Christian friends. You can guess, like having lots of sex for long times, you need lots of drinks and you need those sexually high boys to serve you drinks.
For me, I see it very, very silly, and it's an insult to our brain. Like, how anyone can believe in such a garbage? I mean, 80,000 little boys, and they are youth, and they are horny. And they will be, and not only that, the Quran could describe them, they are white like pearls. Why they have to be white like pearls? Why they have to be so beautiful? You know, what? So obviously the man is enjoying their beauty too. Otherwise, why I need those boys who they are youth, who they are very horny, why they have to have such a look, such a face, and such a design? It doesn't make sense. But the whole idea is, promises is cheap, and Muhammad is speaking to a bunch of Bedouin. The Bedouin, the Arab, they love sex, they love to drink, they love even the Quran. Muhammad himself, he was a heavy drinker, him and Umar al-Khattab and all the Muslims, to the point he became the joke of the town. Everybody, when the Muslim they pray and they are drunk. So Muhammad, after the people start making fun of him, he come with a chapter 4 verse number 43, where it says Allah told Muhammad, supposedly, for sure this is Muhammad, he said to the Muslims, oh, who you believe, approach not prayer when you are drunk. So imagine how much they are obsessed with drinking, those Arab in the time of Muhammad, to the point they cannot pray. When they go to pray, they are falling apart. So they are a bunch of drunken people. So Muhammad, he did not forbid that until he himself cannot drink, and then he says the wine is haram. Now here you will see the contradiction. Why wine in earth is bad, and why wine in heaven is good? Especially,
I have the answer to this question.
Sorry.
I know the answer to this question. All would right, you like go, me to answer?
Go ahead.
So, according to an imam who I spoke, he said Allah wants us to control ourselves in this world, and then we will get the wines in paradise because we deserve it by controlling. And my response to that was, morality of Allah changes while people are in this world. His morality gets worse when people end up in paradise.
But the Muslims don't control anything. The Muslims, Muhammad, he legalized all adultery, and he make it legal, including prostitution. Like, is a prostitution haram in Islam? It's not.
No, that's why we do have lots of grooming gangs in UK. I'm not sure if you heard of it, thanks to teachings of Islam.
I don't know what is that, but prostitution in Islam, as long you are using your slaves, it is halal. Chapter 24, verse number 33, it says that force not your maids, who they are your slaves, into prostitution if they desire not to do so. But however, if you force them, Allah is all merciful and forgiving. There's no punishment in Islam for any Muslim if he uses his slave. She have to be a slave, not a free woman. If he use a slave he own for prostitution, it is legal, it is halal, and there's no problem with that. And the only condition here in the verse, it says, force them not if they choose, which means if you ask her, do you like to do prostitution, and she said, hey, good for me, then business is good. However, even if you force them, Allah is all merciful. The Muslim, they say Allah is merciful for them. Okay, but what is the punishment for prostitution in Islam? You see, the verse doesn't say never do prostitution. The verse is so clear. It says force them not to do prostitution if they choose. If they choose not to do prostitution. And if you force them, Allah is all merciful. So where Muhammad, he says prostitution is forbidden? Nowhere. The verse is so clear. So same time for the Muta. You know the Muta, right?
Yeah, let me just comment on that Surah 24. So in England, it's been almost a decade now, mainly followers of Islam, not Muslim, mainly people who follow the teachings of Islam and identify themselves as people who fast during the Ramadan, who goes to Friday prayers. They pick those young white British girls, mainly British, and then they use those girls, they sold those girls, and they make money from those girls. We call it, like, it's been all over the news, identified as grooming gangs.
But how they get those girls? I don't understand. What did they marry them? What they do?
No, so they pick up those girls from the, like, after school, or those girls go to shop to buy the things, and then they start giving those girls gifts. From that, they are building relationships, they are grooming the girls. And then from that, the girls kind of start, oh yeah, he's my friend. And those people are pretty old when you compare with the age of those children. Youngest child was 9 years old, and then until it goes until 15. I did meet some of the girls who's been groomed, and the way they've been treated by Muslims, if one of the girls wanted to give up and didn't want to kind of be friend with these Muslim men, they were told they will family will hurt one of the lady, one of the girl. They nailed her tongue on the table if she goes back to, if she leaves this gang. It's overall like very sad, ugly. But when we see those Surah 24, verse 33, it makes sense for us why Muslims are using those mainly white British girls to make money from them. Because apparently Allah is all merciful and all forgiving. Allah doesn't have any problem.
I don't want to blame a cult like Islam for what's happening here. Because it's a cult and everything is halal, especially it is not, you know, they cannot do that to Muslim girls. They are doing it only to non-Muslims. So we understand who they are. But I want to blame the society in England. I mean, where is the parents? Where is the family? Where is the mother? Where is the father? Where is the government? Where is the police? Obviously, there is something wrong there.
So our family is already broken. So, social services didn't do their job. Police didn't want to offend Muslim community.
Okay, that's mean England is England is doomed. I mean, you see, a guy is kidnapping a child, forcing her into a sex business, and then you don't want to offend. What kind of a country? This country is gone.
Country needs Jesus.
The country is gone. This England is became a doomed country. So I don't blame a criminal for being a criminal. You know, crime can take place if there's no protection, especially for the young one. So don't blame the criminal only, blame those who allowed the crime to happen. And obviously there's somebody, the criminal here is not only those who commit the crime, it's the government, it's the parents, it's the society who allow such a thing to happen.
Yeah, like everyone has responsibility and everyone did their part is wrong, but still there is an ideology out there gives right to their followers to abuse, buy and sell people who do not share their ideology. That's very ugly and wrong.
Yeah, we know that, but what I'm saying, I know what Islam is about, and I know Islam allowed to take advantage of those who they are not Muslims. But there is other kind of criminals who don't care about religion too, and they would do that. However, if you don't provide protection in any society, the weak ones always, they will be the victims. And obviously the society in England is suffering from a big problem, and the problem is very simple. There is no protection. So Muslims, they have their religion where it allowed in them, you cannot kill a Christian if he is protected, and because he's paying the jizya. But if he is not, you can steal his money. And the same for their women. So they are practicing Islam. Nothing strange here. I mean, if they take those girls and they do to them what they did, we know what Islam is about. But the question is, how will it that happen? So I don't want to blame the Muslims only for what they do or those criminals. I want to blame the whole society. This is a stupid society, sadly. And when people lose their honor, there's nothing else to lose.
When people give up on God, this is what happens.
Well, not only they give up in God, obviously they give even up in normal things a human being he have. I mean, honor. I mean, if you don't have an honor for your children, and you, even cats, even chicken defend their babies. So what happened to those rich people? They are not even chicken no more? You know what I mean? Like, so, if you try to take a chicken, a little chick from her mother, and she is a chicken, she would attack you and she would die to defend her chick. So if a chicken defend her baby, what about those people? What's wrong with them? Obviously, this society have something wrong with it. You know, if I have a child or a daughter, and somebody want to do that to her, you know, I will go crazy. I'm not going to let anyone even get close to my daughter. Obviously, there is something wrong. You know, and always Satan, my dear sister, always Satan, he finds his place when there is a place for him. If there's no place for him, he cannot get in. So this society welcomes Satan. Actually, England became the nest of Satan, because every terrorist in the world, he want to run away, he asked for asylum, England give him asylum.
Okay, I'm not going to comment on that. So can I ask another question?
Sure.
Just changing the topic. Right. So I hear from mainly from Muslims, Muhammad was very good man and he's like very good example. And one of the good thing Muhammad did was feeding a cat. Apparently he give milk to cat. Do you know where this comes from?
Well, you know, the strange is Muhammad, he gave milk to a cat, and there's a hadith says a guy who gave water to a dog, he will go to heaven. Okay. When you hear this, you think that Muhammad was like a guy who believed in Buddha, like he's a Buddha guy, you know, and like he's a spiritual, and he was wearing a robe around himself, and he carried an umbrella on the top of his head, and his name is the Dalai Lama, you know. But isn't Muhammad the same guy who said kill all the dogs?
The black ones, yeah.
No, all the dogs. No, not only the black one. In the beginning, he said kill all the dogs. But when people they start complaining, he switched to the black dog only, because people, they have guard dog, they need dogs. Nobody can live without dogs at that time. So dogs at that time, it was a necessity. It's not a luxury. So in the beginning, Muhammad, he ordered to kill all the dogs. And here we ask ourselves, if Muhammad, he ordered to kill all the dogs, how a person can believe that Muhammad, he gave a cat a milk, and he was a very nice person? It was narrated, and this is Sahih Hadith, the Messenger of Allah raising his voice and commanded that dogs to be killed, and dogs were be killed, except for hunting dogs or dogs kept for hardy livestock. So all dogs were killed. And by the way, this is only after adjustment. In the beginning, Muhammad, he ordered to kill all dogs with no exception. Sahih Muslim. Let us show the hadith number so people will not say we are making things up.
Do you mind sharing your screen, Christian friends?
Yeah.
Are you sharing your screen?
Well, you want me to share in my Skype, you mean?
No. Yeah,
you can share my video. Yeah, no problem. You can share. Sahih Muslim 1570, hadith number A. Or, you know, it says, Ibn Umar said, Allah Messenger giving command for killing dogs. So Muhammad, he ordered to kill the dogs. And then when the people, they start complaining, he switched. He said, okay, kill only those who they are not hardened and not guarding. So anything else, you kill. So why Muhammad, if he is a nice person, want to kill dogs? And Muhammad actually, he says, if not the dogs are nation like other nations, I will order to kill them all. You know? Why?
Okay. Do you have any pets? Do you have any dogs or cats?
No, I don't have.
Guinea pig or anything?
No.
So I've got three dogs, okay?
All right.
Like, they are seriously very lovely. And one of them is puppy. She just chooses everything. Other ones are like a little bit older. I look into their eyes, and when I remember Muhammad wants them dead, it doesn't give me that much nice feelings about Muhammad. Do you think my feelings are correct?
Well, dogs, they have a special sensation. and they can sense evil, you know. So because they can sense evil, I believe Muhammad, he hated them. Each time they see Muhammad, they sense evil in him.
They start barking.
Well, obviously, there's something. I mean, why the guy, he is ordering to kill dogs? I mean, he is a Bedouin man, living in the desert, and everybody need a dog. So a dog, he bark anyway. If you see a stranger, he would do that. But so why you hate all the dogs? Does it make sense? You know? So as you see here, I'm showing the hadith in the screen. People, they can see it.
Yep.
And this is hadith number 1573A. It says that Muhammad, he ordered kill all dogs. All the dogs. And then he made an adjustment. Then he permitted keeping the dogs for hunting and protection. So there is no need for any man. I mean, dogs are very beautiful animals. You know, what if a dog, he is weak? He cannot protect you, but you like him to stay alive, and he is cute. You know, he's funny. The kids are playing with him. According to Muhammad, we kill him.
That's just heartbreaking. I'm double heartbroken about
and,
it.
And you know, this kind of a person, obviously, he have a mental illness, because, you know, I can be maybe a person, he have a phobia from dogs. Maybe one day when he was a kid, he was bitten by a dog. But that is not an excuse, you know, to kill all the dogs. That's stupid, actually, you know. So
dogs are very faithful.
Dogs are very faithful, and they are always the best of friend for a human being. I mean, if a guy, he lost in the middle of nowhere, which one you prefer to have, to be by yourself or to have a dog with you? For sure you will have a dog. So dogs never been a problem. Now, for sure there's some bad dogs, you know, but there's bad human too. You know, if a dog, he bite, there's a human they kill. Should we kill all a human? You know what I mean? So why we need, and then you will see here the superstition of Muhammad. When Muhammad, he says that the black dog, and then he switched to the black dog, and he says you kill not only black dog, any pure black animal. You need to ask yourself, what is the phobia about the black color? Why?
CP. I was told that you are not showing your screen on your channel.
Now it's showing.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah. So the Messenger of Allah said, if it were not that dogs were part of a nation among the nation, then I would order that all of them to be killed. Now here we need to ask ourselves, why Muhammad, he hated dogs so much, and then why he switched to say kill the dogs which is a pure black. They ask him, what is the distinguish between a yellow dog and white dog from a black dog? He said the black dog is the devil, is shaitan. So Muhammad, obviously, he believed that black color is the color of Satan. So you kill, this is why in the Middle East, you will not see, if there's a black horse, he is totally black, they will kill him. If he's totally black, because I've got
three dogs and two of them are black.
Sorry, you had what?
I've got three dogs and two of them are black.
Well, those are the enemy of Allah. You know,
I believe my dogs are made for heaven, but anyway, not for paradise.
Yeah, well, I don't think dogs deserve to go to the paradise of Allah anyway. I mean, it's not nice for them. But here you will notice that this person, he have a mental issue. I mean, a person who is little wise, he should understand that those are poor animals, you know, and we should not kill a dog because he's black or just because he's a dog. That is not only any human unjust. This is an evil. It's stupid. It's stupid to believe that a black dog is Satan, just because he's black. So how in the world Muslims, they can believe in a man like this to be a prophet who tell them about the right and wrong? Isn't it obvious that this is wrong?
I would love to see what the animal lovers will say in 21st century. Well, but that's just a different topic.
You see, a human being, he always was in love with dogs since the beginning of time. This is why dog is the best friend of a human or a man. So to come with such an argument that dogs are bad and dogs should be killed, it's exposing a kind of mental illness for this person.
So just go back to my question on Muslim reasoning that Muhammad was very good man because he fed the cat. So you, like, how long have you been looking into Islam? You are 70, can we say, like, last 60 or 65 years?
Sometime I have over 100 now, you know, by knowledge. No, look, listen. If Muhammad nice to cats, why he is not nice to human?
Oh, well, so just a moment. How long have you been studying Islam? Over 70 years?
Let us say...
Okay, I'll ask much simple if you don't want to share your age. Have you got gray hairs yet?
You see the woman questions.
If you've got gray hairs, that means Islam gave you gray hairs.
I don't know. Last time I looked at the mirror, it was a long time ago. So don't ask me those questions.
Okay.
Anyway, maybe I don't even have hair. How you know? Maybe I'm like Sam Shamoon.
Like, it doesn't matter you've got hair or not. God still loves you, and yes, Lord Jesus Christ died for you.
But
I just wanted to find out.
Yeah, listen to me.
I'm assuming you've been studying Islam for a long time.
It's not about how long you study. It's about how deep you study. There's many people, they study. You see, there's working hard and there's working smart. There's a person who works so hard, but he cannot accomplish. And there's somebody, he works smart, little than the one who works so hard. So we need to work smart, not only hard.
Okay. In your smart studying, have you got what would be your top 10 things, like, if you force and really, really force that you come across that Muhammad was a good man because these top 10 things?
Well, there's the top good things about Muhammad are evil, because if Muhammad, he did give milk to a cat, what about Muhammad letting the women who insulted him, and she is over 80 years old, let her go instead of cutting her to pieces? That's mean Muhammad is mentally ill, because you are merciful to the cat by giving her milk, but yet a woman over the age of 80, you cut her to pieces when she's alive. So that is a proof that Muhammad is mentally ill, because this is not a mercy. That's a madness. Like, there's a guy who is a king who give his cat a milk, but then he throw you to the cat to eat you. His cat is a tiger. You know what I mean? So I have a cat and she is a tiger, and then I give my cat a milk, and now my cat, she is licking my fingers. And then after that, I am so merciful to the point I will throw a human being in the front of my tiger because the tiger is hungry. So now I am merciful. So Muhammad, he sacrificed mankind, yet they call him a merciful prophet. How many millions of people get killed because of Muhammad? Muhammad, he did give milk to the cat. But the question, how many millions can get killed because of Muhammad?
So the Muslims
are trying to fool us, saying Muhammad, he saved the cat, he killed millions. This is the point. My prophet is so good, he gave milk to the cat, but he crucified people, and he put nails in their eyes, and he put them in the cross, and he cut their hands, and he cut their feet, and he put nails in their eyes, and he is merciful by giving milk to a cat.
I am glad that there is something, since we are all in the same page. I thought pretty hard, but I couldn't even find any nice thing about Muhammad.
Well,
not good at all.
You see, Muslims, they can't, you see, that when a person is desperate, he tried to find something to make Muhammad look nice. So they start quoting stories which we find it actually hilarious. Like as an example, the Muslim, they say that there was a Jewish guy, he pissed always and he throw garbage in the door of the Prophet. All right, this is a story we hear it always. There's a Jew guy, he always be, but where we can find this story? Who is the Muslim want to show me the story? There's no reference for the story. A Jew, he used to come to the Prophet and he pissed in the door of the Prophet and he there's no garbage in the Prophet and the Prophet one day his son blah blah blah. Okay, I want to see the story. So Muslims, they fabricate tons of stories about their Prophet, but all the reference saying that Muhammad obviously is an evil person. Imagine Muhammad, the one who did feed the cat, he gagged the eyes of a human being. He put nails in fire and he gagged their eyes. So how he is a merciful person, even if somebody wanna be punished.
What is that the story where Muhammad made people to drink camel urine? Is that story?
Yes, this is the same story. Yeah, this is the same story. But what about, you know, putting nails in their eyes? I mean, okay, let us say somebody, he deserved to be punished. But what kind of punishment will reach out to the point, I'm going to put nails, a piece of irons in the fire, and then I will push those iron when you are alive in your eyes. This is a horror movie. Imagine if we can record Muhammad doing that.
Very peaceful man, very mercy to the world.
So we will make a movie, and the movie showing in the beginning Muhammad giving milk to the cat, and there's a romantic music in the background, and then in the second part of the movie the Prophet is cutting hands and feet and crucifying people in the cross, and then they bring in nails, he heat it in fire and he push it inside the eyes of those people when they are alive screaming, and then he let them die slowly. So here we go, this is Muhammad who he did give milk to the cat. So you know, I believe Hitler, he used to have a cat too. You know, and he burned 6 million Jews, but he have a cat.
Okay, I'm changing the topic. So go back to the paradise. I'm curious about paradise. It's not because I want to end up there, because I concern for Muslims who are hoping to end up there. So we do have those virgins. We do have those boys who are like hyper with their sexual desire. They are serving all those wines, yet they're not going to get drunk. What else do we have in this paradise? What is paradise offering Muslim woman if they ever make to paradise, since they are not clever enough?
Muhammad, he promised that Muslim women, there will be 70 time or beauty. But I find that this is very stupid promise. And I will explain in the screen why this is very stupid for those who want to use their brain. Imagine. Let me do this in the screen. We have a woman, her name is Fatima. I'm typing Arabic. Fatima. And then another woman, her name is Khadija. And then another woman, her name is Aisha. So three women, and the three of them, they are Muslims. The first one, her beauty is one compared to the one after it, which means the one after it is twice more pretty, and the one after it is it three times more beauty from the first one. Okay. Now, if we give a beauty to all of them 70 times, you will notice that nothing changed. Because Fatima, she will be 70 times more pretty. And Khadija will be 140 times more pretty.
So people are not pretty enough in this world, and Allah is giving them anti-aging creams and making them pretty, pretty in equal level.
No, what I'm saying, nothing changed.
I know.
Nothing changed. You're still, excuse me, I don't like to use this word. I mean, like people, they say ugly, but let's use it as a street word. So if she was ugly in earth, she is ugly in heaven still, because Fatima, she will go to heaven, and still Aisha, she is 210 times more beauty than her. And Khadija, she is now 140 times, and now she is 70 times, so it is still the same. So what the point?
And are they going to watch over their husband go and sleep with other people?
Oh yeah, they, you know, the, you know, they are, they Allah will take the jealousy from their heart. So in the heaven, women, they will be like sex toys. They don't have feeling. So this is why they have no jealousy. They don't get jealous.
That's not very good at all, because if you love someone, that you directly become jealous.
No, those women, they don't love the man. They don't even know the man. They never met the man.
But they will be, weren't they their wives in this world? I'm talking about the like Muslim wife who makes the paradise with their husband. For example, those wife of jihadis. If when jihadi is going to intercede for them, let's say sake of the argument, they make the paradise. What's going to happen to them?
This is what I'm saying. Allah will take the jealousy from those women in the heaven. So the women in the heaven, she will not have any jealousy, even not only the virgins, all women. Actually, this is in the Quran. Let us go to the Quran and find the verse, and we will show the Muslims the translation, which they are their own translation, not our translation. If you go to chapter 7, verse number 43, it says that Allah, He took from their heart all kind of feeling, anything. So in the heaven of Allah, there's nothing will disturb you as a person. No feeling, no jealousy, nothing. Same, you know, same if you go in chapter 15, verse number 74. Like here, the translation is like making it, a translation here, a sense of injury. What does that mean, sense of injury? Sense of injury, like you will not be injured in a sensual way. So in the heaven of Allah, you will be reclining in your bed, and nobody have, bad feelings. So there's no jealousy.
I'm not sure as a woman if I think that's a good thing. I wouldn't say that's a good thing. If you
Muhammad,
what makes human is like,
it's not about it's a good thing or not. I mean, this is a false promise anyway. And Muhammad, he is trying to explain to the followers, obviously one of them, he's asking him, how we will deal with those women. I mean, a lot of women, and I will have sex with all of them, they will be fighting, they will give me headache. So Muhammad, he wanted to make it, okay, don't worry. Allah will take jealousy from their heart, so they will not have any jealousy. So Muhammad, always his promises is a solution of problems human being he suffer from in this earth. So when Muhammad, he promised you something in heaven, simply is to make you feel better, not to make you feel more horrible. So he promised that in this heaven you will not have those problems you have here. Women, they will not be jealous because you are having sex in front of them with other women. No, actually, they will be happy for you.
Of course, that makes sense, because those wives or those women won't have mother. Therefore, men are not going to get mother-in-law. That gives extra peace to them.
Well, not only that, even the women themselves, they will not have the jealousy. The women herself. Yeah. Yeah, there's no mother-in-law in there. And not only that, you have my book, Sex and Allah. You will see that all the women who Allah promised the Muslims, they are a special kind of women. All of them, they have the same face, the same height, the same voice. They sing the same song, and all of them, their name is Hur. Now, look at this. Imagine I have 100,000 women, but all of them, they look the same. I mean, how stupid that is. So what the point?
Which one is which?
What the point of sleeping with all of them? I mean, sleep with one, sleep with all, you know, because they have the same name and they say the same words. Each time the guy, he finished with the women, she will say to him, you are the best. Which means you are the best in sex. But how she is saying to him that if she is a virgin? How a virgin she knew that he is the best? She never saw a guy other than him. She never even saw a man before, you know. Not only she did not sleep with the man, because the Quran says it clearly that those women are maqsuratun fil khiyam, which means they are jailed in their tents. So how they say to the man after he have sex with them, you are the best man, you are so good in bed, man. Really, I never saw a man like you. But she is supposedly jailed. She never saw a man before.
That's another reason we should encourage no one to become a Muslim.
And not only that, you know, here you will see that Allah, he promised that those virgins, not only like he didn't say the virgin, you see the people, they say virgins. The Quran never say virgin, by the way. Quran never say the word virgins. The Quran describe the skin inside the women vagina. Never use the word virgin. And this is telling us how trashy the author of the Quran, because there's many words, nicer words. You can say the word virgin. What's wrong with the word virgin? In Arabic, it says adara. Adara is virgin. That's it. There's no need to say and to speak about making them bleed, make their vagina bleed. So why Muhammad, he chose such a statement to say about those women? There's no genie and there's no man had sex with them. And by the way, here we need to take into consideration that Muslim believe that Muslim women, they are available not only for a human, they are available for genie. That's why the Quran says that there's no man, neither a genie, did have intercourse and break the skin inside their private part and make them bleed.
That's just lovely.
Yeah. It's one of the fictions of Muhammad, you know.
Still, I'm questioning why billions of people are falling into these traps and following this man.
As I said, you know, like foolishness, okay. Foolishness is exist, and people, they are free to be fooled. You know, if somebody want to be fooled, what he can do for him, let go and then be a fool. But I know that even those who convert to Islam, they don't really stay long there. They, you know, after a while, because you see, Muslims, when they promote their cult, they lie. So they might find some naive people who they don't know, and they fail into the trap as any scam. But as soon they wake up and they notice that what they told them is a lie, they leave. Same time, a lot of Muslims are leaving Islam. You know, there is a revolution now in South Africa, in Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco. People are leaving Islam as never before. So even in Syria, even in Jordan, even in Egypt, so they are leaving Islam, big deal. But because of the nature of this cult, it's a gang cult, they don't announce themselves. If somebody convert to Islam, the Muslim, they will make 10,000 video for him, interview, conferences, they invite them, Allahu Akbar, this guy, he was like this guy, his name is Yusuf State, he was an idiot. But if somebody leave Islam, how many videos we see of him? No, none. Few people, they make videos, and if they make it, they will be living in the West. I never saw somebody leaving Islam. Have you ever heard of a country have zero atheist? Islamic countries have zero atheist. There's no way. I mean, the whole country have zero atheist, but because nobody dare to make a, to say I'm an atheist. Zero. When Ahmadinejad, the ex-president of Iran, he came to United Nations, he says we have zero gays in Iran. Why? Because nobody dare to say he's a gay. They will kill him immediately. So in order to know how many Muslims, between those who call themselves Muslims, give them freedom, and then we will know. As long as there's no freedom, I believe that those Muslims are not exist. You see, I believe in a Muslim who is a Muslim in England to be Muslim more than a Muslim who live in Saudi Arabia, because in Saudi Arabia he have no choice or chance to be or not to be. But a guy who live in England, he can leave, or let us say, you know, he can go around it, or somebody live in America. But you live in Saudi Arabia, that's it. There is no way you can get around it. You have to say, I'm a Muslim.
I did met with a girl. She was graduated from Cambridge, and she did become a Muslim.
Hmm.
And she got married with the guy who make her to say Shahada.
Okay.
I met with her. You know about halala marriage? I met her where she was waiting for halala husband. And this girl is graduated from Cambridge. In somehow, when she became a Muslim, she left probably her brain in somewhere else. She was waiting for halala husband, and she was thinking that's very okay and that's very good. Well, I just thought that was very ugly for someone who became
a woman. She joined a religion or a cult because of a man. She is not really converting. I mean, as soon he leave her, she will change and she will be turned a Hindu if the next guy is a Hindu. So whoever in the bed, I will accept his religion. This is the whole story. But this is not really, you know, I mean, this is not about Cambridge or, and being a graduate from Cambridge, not doesn't make you smart. That's because you are rich mostly, not because you are smart.
Still in my mind, I had an idea that they are exercising their brain. But in somehow, she didn't even think there was something wrong that for her to go back to her.
I think she is exercising her brain, and she don't care for the religion. She care for having the man. So her brain is focusing in one direction. It's the same as a guy. He don't care really about dignity. He care about making money. So, you know, he work in any kind of business will make money. It doesn't matter, including drugs. So they practice, they have their brain, but it is not important for her to be a Muslim or not. The important is to have the man. So if the man is a target, it doesn't matter what the man is, she will be what the man he want. You know what I mean?
I just think it's,
you know,
just
once a Muslim woman, she was desperately, she said, I will convert to Christianity if you marry me. I said, I will not marry you, first of all. Secondly, if you convert to Christianity because of me, that means you are a liar. You are not a good woman. She said, how is that? I just proved to you that I love you. The point, I will convert to Christianity. I said, this is the point. You don't love, you, in order to have me, you are willing to sell yourself to anything. So if Christianity is not convincing for you, and then still you are willing to change just because you want to have me, that means you are an evil person. You are for sale. Anyone can buy you. So a person who do that, he have no dignity, and he is for sale. And if a woman, she want to change, or a man, he change his belief just for the sake of having a woman or a man, that means this person have no dignity and not trustworthy. Tomorrow she will love different man and she will change her religion.
It's just double ugly. Another general knowledge question. So let's say we don't have something called hadith. We've got what Islam is only represented by Quran itself. And what are the verses you would keep within the Quran and get rid of the rest to make Quran more logical?
That is maybe the hardest question ever I got in my life. There's no single chapter in the Quran is logical. Starting from the first chapter Muhammad received to the last chapter he have. So what is logical? I mean, have you ever heard of, I will give you an example. I will give you something simple, not complicated. When Muhammad, he says, today I choose for you Islam as a religion. What was that day? If you go in the Quran, you will see chapter 5, verse number 3. Muhammad, he says to them, you cannot eat this, you cannot eat that, you cannot eat pork, you cannot eat, etc. And it's like saying, you can eat falafel, you cannot eat pork, you can eat chicken, you cannot eat ham, you cannot, etc. And then suddenly, after saying all those about food, suddenly he says, today, I completed my favor upon you. Choose Islam as a religion for you. Okay, hold on. Today, Islam completed because you said to us, you can eat a chicken, you cannot eat pork. So what is the rest of the Quran? This is chapter 5, verse number 3. We have almost the whole Quran after. But today, Quran, Islam is perfected. And how it's perfected? Because Muhammad, he said to me, you cannot eat pork. I mean, how serious that is. So how the Quran, how Islam can make sense? And this is a sentence, if it exists, it should be the last sentence in the Quran. The last thing, a person, he is like Jesus on the cross, he says it's completed. That's it, it's done. Muhammad here saying, this day, not tomorrow, this day, that's it. He's talking about the time. I have perfected for you your religion, completed my favor upon you, and have chosen for you Islam as your religion. So what is the rest of the Quran? So when you say to me, what is in the Quran makes sense? That is the hardest question for me, because nothing in the Quran makes sense. If we ask a Muslim, why in the Quran it's forbidden for you to eat pork? He do not know. I change the Muslim to tell me why. That's it. Quran says don't eat pork, but there's no explanation. Why I cannot eat this? Why I cannot eat that? No explanation. Not even the hadith. Why there's no I cannot have fun, why I cannot play music, why I cannot play football. Even football in Islam is haram, by the way. Muslim today, they're not Muslims, they are fake Muslims. Everything they do today is haram. Every Muslim, he have a stereo in his car. Every Muslim, he listen to music. Every Muslim, he watch TV. And all of this is haram in Islam. All of this is forbidden. Art, pictures, cameras, all is haram. Muhammad, he said that a person who draw a picture, Allah will bring him in the judgment day, and he will ask him to blow in it as if he is going to create it, and he will torture him for that. And pictures by cameras is no different. It's haram. Muhammad, he says, angels will not enter a house have a picture. So why Muslims have pictures? Find me any Muslim, he don't have tons of pictures in his phone. Even the one who have a long beard. If pictures is haram, how Muslims they have pictures? And why they have it? Because simply, they cannot practice Islam. Islam is a silly, stupid cult. So this is what the Muslims they do. They convince themselves, I am a Muslim, Islam is great, but don't ask me about the details. The details is stupid, and my prophet is stupid. So I'm not going to discuss details with you, but I'm a Muslim. But don't ask me why I listen to music. Don't ask me why I have a TV. Don't ask me why I have pictures in my house when all of this is forbidden. So what is halal in Islam? To eat and have sex. That's it. This is the halal.
There are 6,236 verses in the Quran, and there is none one verse you would keep to make Quran logical. That says a lot about Islam, though.
Well, there is a verse in the Quran, we have to be honest, it's very logical. The one it says you can eat in your house, in your house. I mean, look how silly this cult is. Have you ever heard of a God? He needed to come with verses saying to its followers, by the way, you are allowed. If you are blind, if you are lame, if you cannot walk straight, you are allowed to eat in your house. And even if you are not sick or blind or lame, you can still eat in your house. And not only that, you can eat the house of your parent, and you can eat in the house of your aunts, and you can eat the house of your brothers. I mean, have you ever heard of a silly, stupid cult like this before? So this is a God, obviously he have nothing to do. He want to talk, you know, like there is some people when they get so old and, you know, they lose their control of their mind. And with my respect to the old, by the way, I'm not making fun of them, but this is something happened. So when you became your life boring and you start you wanna occupy your life, so you start talking, even if your talk does not make sense. So what kind of God in the world, he says, there's no problem if you eat in your house. No problem if you eat in the house, if you are blind and you where the blind will eat. I mean, usually before Islam, a blind, he eat where? He eat in a restaurant. In the time of Muhammad, there was restaurants in Mecca, in Quraysh. There's no restaurant. So what do you mean? There's no fault if you are blind, nor if you are born lame, nor if you are illness, suffering from illness, nor if you are yourself, which means you are not any of those, to eat in your home. What? God writing to me, saying to me, it is not sin to eat in your home.
So he's giving you permission to eat in your home.
So where usually we used to eat, in the house of the neighbor? And then, not only that, this guy, when I keep talking, he don't stop. And then he says, nor in the house of your father, or the house of your mother, or your brothers, or your sisters, or your father brother, or your father sisters, or your mother brothers, or your mother sisters, or in the house of which you have keys. So now, if you are a Muslim and you have a Muslim friend, you give him the key of your house, he is allowed to eat your food in the fridge. Don't ever give a Muslim the key of your house, even if he's a real estate agent. According to the Quran, a real estate agent, he is a Muslim, he will eat your food as long as he have the keys, as you see. And then any house, it's in your possession, and or in the house of a sincere friend of yours, there is no blame on you. And then actually it says there is no sin of you if you eat alone or separately. Alone. So when you talk about logical and wisdom, I find the Quran, I mean, the most hilarious comedy book. The Quran made the baby, is sperm became a congealed blood, and then women, they have a sperm coming from their breast, and men, they have a sperm coming from their backbone, and the sun set in the murky water, and the sun rise from a certain place, and there is a people, it's called Gog and Magog, and yet we cannot find them, and they are every one of them. He will live before he die. He will give birth to a 1,000 Gog and Magog, which means those Gog and Magog, if we are now 7 or 8 billions, they should be maybe trillions by numbers. But yet we cannot find one of them. It's like the Bigfoot in America. So when you say to me, what is logical in Islam? I say the only logical is to believe that stupidity exists. And we have to accept the fact that as long as there is stupidity, always there will be stupid. And that is Islam.
So that's the miracle of Islam as well.
No, there's other miracle. The other miracle is
to
make someone believe in stupidity, you know.
Yeah, doesn't make sense, yet it is miracle of Islam. What is the funniest verse of the Quran, you think? Is the Surah 2461 is the funniest one, or do you have
depend on the topic, like what the topic is about? Is if it's about something silly, yeah, this is very silly, and etc. But if you want something let us say more silly, when it's about logic, is it chapter 3 verse number 65.
Let's look at that one.
This one, it says, Allah supposedly is talking, not Muhammad as usual. Ye people of the book, why dispute ye about Abraham when the law and the gospel were not revealed till after him? Have you no understanding? Which means, are you stupid or what? So look how stupid the one who made this verse is. If the one who came after cannot dispute about the one who came before, so how Muhammad, who came at the end, he dispute about anything? Think about it carefully. I don't know how slow people are, but it's clear. Muhammad saying, hey, you Christians and Jews, how you can dispute, how you can debate me about Abraham when you came after Abraham. But based on this, Muhammad himself, he cannot debate them too, because the Jews are older than the Christians and older than Muhammad. And then the Christians are older than Muhammad himself. So all of them, they will win and he will lose. So how silly this stupid argument is.
You know, it's Islam.
Huh?
It is Islam.
It is Islam. It's exactly Islam. So here you will notice the stupidity of the author, because this is, it's like, you know, let us say I am 17 and you are I cannot say that to a woman. You are 17 and someone else is 25. So the one who is 17 is saying to the older, you cannot debate me because I am exist before you. But here he's saying he is the last one. So don't ask me about what is silly in the Quran. All of it is silly. What about the first verse Muhammad received? The Muslim, they say to us that the first verse Muhammad received is when Allah says to him, "Iqra, read." How silly to say to someone who do not know how to read, read. Who is the stupid here, Allah or Muhammad? Because if Muhammad do not know how to read, and Allah, he said to Muhammad, read. And then Muhammad, he says to him, I cannot read. And then the angel, he squeezes him again, and he says to him, read. And then the guy, he says to him, I cannot read. And the angel, he squeezes him again for the second time, and he said to him, read. And the Muhammad, he repeat again, like, what's wrong with this guy? I keep saying to him, I cannot read. He squeezed me. I cannot read, I told you. And then he squeezed him for the third time, and he said to him, read. And all of this for what? Still Muhammad cannot read, and he doesn't understand what to read. So what is squeezing for? And why Allah is using the wrong word? So from the first verse to the last verse is stupid. Or what about the second verse? Allah created the man out of a clot of a congealed blood. Who is the stupid who want to believe that a human being is created from a clot of a blood, dead blood? And then Allah, he says that he is the one who taught the man by the pen, but the man is not, the pen is not created by Allah. And if Allah is talking about the pen which he have in heaven, so what the pen he have in heaven have to do with me? I never saw it. I never received a book from him. Even the Quran, never written by Allah, never collected by Allah. It was collected by a guy, his name was Uthman, and he burned all the other Quran. So where is the pen of Allah, and what this is about?
I do have actually concern. I do have a question to you. So, okay. Pen was very important to Allah since he created that, like, in early stages. And Muhammad is his last prophet. And Allah dealt with Muhammad for 23 years through angel Gabriel. What do you think reason that Muhammad didn't even bother to learn how to read and write? What was he busy with?
You see, first of all, the Muslims, when I debate Muslims, I debate them about their belief. But my belief is different. My belief, I believe that Muhammad, he knew how to write, how to read. But as long as this is what they believe, I have to go with it. If you go in the Quran, just to show you how ignorant the Muslims, we are the Christians, we teach them Islam. The Quran never said that Muhammad did not know how to read. The Quran says that the word ummi is anyone who do not know the book. As an example, chapter 2, verse number 78, this is the first time the word appear. وَمِنْهُمْ أُمِّيُّونَ, and among them illiterate, they know not the book. So illiteracy in the Quran never been about knowing how to write, how to read. This is why we Christians and Jews are called people of the book. Why? Because we are not illiterate about God. But the foolishness of Islam is amazing. They take this as illiteracy about writing or reading, but the fact, it's clear. Those who do not know the book are illiterate, not those who do not know how to write, how to read. If you ask the Muslims, actually the verse after it, it says, then, you know, like, those who write the book with their hands, Allah will curse them. So the book of what we are talking about? The book of God. So illiteracy is about not knowing the book of God, not knowing God. This is something Muhammad, he took from the Jews. The Gomai in for the Jews are the illiterate, not illiterate about not knowing how to write, which means the Greek are illiterate for them because they worship fake gods. So for the Hebrew Jews, all the Greek are illiterate. But the Greek, all of us, we knew they are philosophers, they have a great civilization, they knew how to write, they speak languages, so how they can be illiterate? They are illiterate about God. But the Muslims, they are very limited in their thinking. They are copy-paste and nobody want to use his brain. And that not only that, all over, chapter 3, verse number 20, it says, so if they dispute with thee, say, I have surrendered whole myself to Allah. He they say submitted. The false translation, surrender. Islam means surrender, not submit. And then he says, and say to the people of the book, and those who they are unlearned or illiterate. Do you see it? So what the Quran again confirm that there's two kinds of people. People who they are illiterate, and there's people who have a book. So anyone have a book, which means the Christian and the Jews, is called the people of the book. But there's no way all the Christians and the Jews at that time, they knew how to write and to read. Actually, until now, there's people who they are Christians, do not know how to write and read in some villages in the middle of nowhere in Africa, etc. So, but still they are called the people of the book. And those who don't have a book, it's called illiterate. But again, Muslims are the last one to understand what Islam is about. And this is why even Muhammad himself, do you remember what the Quran says about asking the Christians?
Yeah, if he's in a dark, he needs to ask the people of the book.
Thank you very much. So why Muhammad himself? Allah told him, if you have a question about God, to know God, go and ask the Christians and the Jews. This is Muhammad. This is not Mimi Hijab and his nurse Ali Dawa. Muhammad himself, if you have a question about the true God, he have to come to Christian Prince to ask him, and he will receive the answer. And that because we are the people of God. And here I want to remind everybody that when the Quran call us the people of the book, the Quran witnessing that we are the only one who have a book, not the Muslims. Muslims never been called once people of the book in the Quran itself, for simply they don't and they never had a book. And when the Quran says that the Christians are the people of the book, including the Jews, he confirmed not only our book is not corrupted, he confirmed that we are the only one who have the truth. Because if we, the Muslim, they say that the Bible is corrupt, so how silly, how stupid to say the people of the book, but their book is not exist no more. Who is the donkey here? Somebody is a donkey. So the second you say, imagine I say the guy with the car, but he don't have a car no more. So how we can keep calling him the guy with the car? And we are talking about people in the time of Muhammad, not people after or before. So the people of the book, but do they have a book or not? Obviously they have. Otherwise, how you call them with the people of the book? And book of what we are talking about? The book of God. So the second the Quran call us such a name, we are giving an honor Muslims do not have, and Muhammad himself do not have. And as you see, the Quran confirm, if a Muslim have a question, if Muhammad have a question, he have to come to the Christian and ask them. And here there's a question which Muslims cannot answer. Why Muhammad he have a doubt in his heart about him being a prophet? He is the prophet. If Muhammad himself cannot believe he's a prophet, how in the world any crazy person will believe him? You know what I mean?
Good question.
If Muhammad have a doubt, he's the prophet. He's the one who been squeezed by Jibreel 3 times like a mayonnaise. So no ketchup came out, no mayonnaise, and still Muhammad he have a doubt after all of this. So half of the Quran is given to Muhammad, and yet Muhammad he have a doubt about himself being a prophet. And not only that, if you remember the hadith, where the hadith says that the prophet he tried to commit suicide many times. I mean, yeah, isn't it obvious that Muhammad have a mental illness? A person who is a prophet of God, when they commit suicide, why?
False God, false prophet.
The mental, he's suffering from mental illness. This guy, he need a shrink. He need to go and see a doctor, you know? So And you know, the Muslim, they say to us, the Prophet, he saw an angel, okay, an angel who have 600 wings. But the Quran says that all the angels of Allah who sent to earth, they are even either have 2 wings, 3 wings, or 4 wings. So how Muhammad, he saw angels with the 3 wings, with 600 wings? So Muhammad, you know, obviously is a very funny man, and
maybe he didn't put his glasses on.
No, this is a sahih hadith. That's it. The Muslim, he believed, he says 600 wings. That's it. So he cannot change the number now. So, and by the way, how an angel can have 3 wings? I mean, this would be funny. The ink is the third wing is weird in his head, like a rooster. So praise be to Allah who created out of nothing the heaven and the earth. This is a Muslim translation. Who made angels, messengers with wings, 2 or 3 or 4. And by the way, here they put between two bracket pairs. That's a lie. There's no pairs there in the translation. This is why it was between two bracket. And by the way, even if that is true, 2, 3, 4, still how would Jibreel, he have 600 wings?
No. I'm like more convinced in that hadith probably Muhammad wasn't wearing his glasses, therefore he didn't see well enough.
Well, Muhammad obviously you know, I believe Muhammad is a person who is suffering from mental illness. And
side of good vision,
I don't think this is about good vision. I think he's a person that's suffering literally from mental illness. And you know, it is possible that Muhammad, he imagined things which is not true. And actually, even the hadith confirmed that. If you remember, the Muslim, they say, and the wives of Muhammad says that Muhammad, he imagined he has done something, in fact, he never did. It's yeah. A Sahih Bukhari, it says,
that was bad one, though.
Once the Prophet was bewitched, so that he began to imagine that he had done a thing which in fact he had not done. So now how we can guarantee that Muhammad seen an angel, not a zucchini? Because now the Prophet, he might see a zucchini, he think it's an angel speaking to him. Or he might see a watermelon, and he think the watermelon is an elephant. So a person, and by the way, when the Muslim, they say the Prophet was bewitched, that's mean, I have the right to say Muhammad the bewitched. I'm not insulting. You see, if I say Muhammad the bewitched, am I insulting? No, the hadith says Muhammad the bewitched. So how he is a prophet yet he is bewitched? And you know what bewitched mean? If you ask any Muslim what bewitched mean, he says they put a black magic on him, but black magic is from Shaitan. Okay, but how that can happen? Isn't it the Quran says that Allah said to the shaitan, you have no authority over my servants except the criminals and the bad and the evil one who follow ye. So in order for shaitan to put a black magic on Muhammad, he have to be an evil person. And that's what the Quran says in chapter 5 verse number 42.
Allah is prophesying about Muhammad in the Quran.
No, Muhammad, Allah is not prophesying. This is Muhammad getting himself busted.
Yeah, like he's just like telling, I'm now going to describe you about myself.
Well, you see here, if Shaitan have no authority over any Muslim, not only Muhammad, even normal Muslim, except the one who follow thee. So here, for Muhammad to be under black magic, he have to be following thee, which means shaitan. Otherwise shaitan have no authority over him. And authority here mean you cannot do anything to them, you cannot harm them, you cannot make them follow you. Only one will follow you is those who they are bad, the criminals. So how Muhammad, he became under the threat, or he became under the influence of the black magic, unless he is following thee?
It is sad. Like, it just, like, as I hear more, as I see more, it just helps me to see how much this breaks heart of God, because there are billions of people are not aware of those things, or they are leaving their brain in somewhere and they messed up in this ideology. It is very sad for mankind. It is very sad.
You know, mankind will, everybody will face the consequence of his belief at the end of the day. Even Shaitan in Islam, by the way, Shaitan is a Muslim. I don't know if you know that. Shaitan, yeah, Shaitan is a Muslim and he is a good guy, actually. The same chapter we're reading from, chapter 15, verse number 39, Iblis, he said to Allah, because you put me in the wrong, because you made me do wrong, because awaitani, yeah. Actually awaitani is not even make me do wrong, it's about you deceive me and you did lie to me. So Allah is the one who did deceive Shaitan. So Shaitan is a victim. And this is why you see Muhammad, I don't know if you know the hadith about Muhammad, speaking about Adam and Moses are debating.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, it was. It, like, I can't do something which I was predestined. Yeah.
Right. So it's a predestiny. That means Shaitan himself, the plan of Shaitan is a predestiny too. Because Shaitan here is just doing the plan of Allah. Allah, he made a destiny before he created Adam that he should be deceived. And Adam, he's saying, are you blaming me? Yeah. Are you blaming me for an action which Allah had written in my fate 40 years before my creation? What does that mean? What exactly happened there? Shaitan supposedly he whispered into Adam and Eve and he deceived them. But that's mean not only we can't blame Adam, we can't blame Shaitan. For this is the plan of Allah. He wrote in the beginning, I will send Shaitan to deceive Adam. Adam will become a victim. Then I kick Adam out of heaven, for he is being deceived. And Adam here saying, you cannot blame me for that because this is a destiny Allah he made for me, even 40 years before my creation. Which mean, and Muhammad he agree, that Adam was the winner of the debate. So which mean at the end of the day, Shaitan himself and Adam are victims of the games of Allah. The bad person here is Allah, not Shaitan, not Adam.
So Allah did something which is very good at deceiving.
Deceiving. This is why my book is the first book I made. It's called The Deception of Allah, because all of this religion is about deceiving. So why? And by the way, here there's something no Muslim can answer us. This is Musa. Musa's arguing with Adam, saying to him, "Because of you, we are out of heaven." That means Musa's he is a Christian. He believes in Christianity, not a Muslim as they claim. Because that's mean Musa's believe in the original sin, that because of Adam we are out of heaven. So now Musa is dead. How he is a prophet of God, but yet Musa's, the Muslim Musa's I'm talking about, he do not understand the original sin yet. After he die, he have a debate with Adam and he lost the debate. So imagine you have a prophet of God. We ask him, do you believe in the original sin, Musa's? Musa's, he answered, Khabibi, yes, Khabibi, I believe in the original sin, Khabibi. And then Musa's, aren't you Muslim, Khabibi, Musa's? He says, yes, I'm a Muslim. But Musa's, the Muslim don't believe in the original sin. So how you believe in this, Musa's? So when the Muslim, they say to us, Musa's was a Muslim, that is a stupid thing. Because here we go, even original sin is an idea which Musa's believe in, and this is after he died. And by the way, when Moses he met with Adam, any Muslim can explain to us? Maybe they went like to the Caribbean islands in a cruise together. Adam and Moses are dead.
Probably they got free tickets, end up in Las Vegas, and then they had their chit chat, and then chit chat turned to be debate, and sadly one of them lost the debate.
Yeah. Well, what we can say, stupidity. But anyway, I'm so glad that Muhammad is so foolish, because that will help us to expose his foolishness. It's going to be hard or harder on us if he's a smart person. So I'm so grateful that he is who he is and he keep talking. This guy, he cannot keep his mouth shut. And because of that, he's helping us. So I am so happy that the Muslims, they have the hadith, and I'm so happy that they preserve the Quran, even the rest of it. Because if you remember the Quran, Umar, he said that the Quran was 1,000 letter and 27,000 letter. and what is left today is not even 25 to 30% of the Quran. The hadith says that even the goat eat the Quran. However, we are so happy that the Muslims were able to preserve whatever left of it, so we can love together at such a belief. It's a comedy. It's a comedy. It's silly. It's stupid. And not only that, I will show you one more comedy about Shaitan.
Okay.
You know that Muhammad, he said that Shaitan, he command him.
Yeah.
Okay. How Muhammad is a prophet of Allah, but he received command from Shaitan.
That's why he's prophet of Allah.
And he received command to do good. This is a good Shaitan. Muslims, this is Sahih Muslim, hadith number 2814a. Your prophet saying that the devil, the companion of Allah Messenger, the devil, this is not just a genie, by the way. This is not a genie. This is because the devil is a genie, but not every genie is a devil. This is why your translation saying is the devil. Do you see it? So this is the Shaitan. He is commanding your prophet to do good. Question: your prophet received command from Allah or from the devil?
That's only Allah knows, I guess. Allah knows best.
Well, it says in front of us, it says he does not command me, but for good. So Muhammad, he obeys Shaitan, but he claimed that the Shaitan is a good Shaitan. I never heard of a good Shaitan. If you ever met one, let's say hi to him.
In world of Islam, you do have a lot.
Yeah, so it's a silly. I mean, just read and you will laugh. And Muhammad, he confirmed that this is Shaitan. Even Aisha, she said to him, your Shaitan, he come to you, huh? And by the way, when Aisha, she said to Muhammad, your Shaitan, when Muhammad, he said to Aisha, your Shaitan come to you. This is a wife trying to play with the hair of Muhammad, and Muhammad, yet he says to her, did your Shaitan come to you? Why is that? Why if a wife, she want to play with the hair of the husband, Shaitan is accused? Don't you see, Muslim, that there's something wrong with this man? Because it's a lawful for a woman to touch her husband. It is lawful for the man to touch his wife. So why Shaitan is behind the touch of Aisha? Obviously, Muhammad, he say things which is not right, because this is Allah. Allah, he put a desire in her heart, supposedly. Isn't Muslim, they say that Allah, he made Aisha in love with Muhammad? So now Aisha, she tried to touch Muhammad. That is Shaitan who is trying to make her do that. How so?
Well, we have Shaitan, which even comes between husband and wife within marriage. That's not very safe marriage, isn't it?
Yeah, and Shaitan, he round himself around the penis of the man if you don't say a prayer before he have intercourse.
What a crazy religion. Good for Muslims. Good for Muslims.
All right. Anything else, sister?
No. What time do you want to go?
Well, I don't know. It's getting late for you, isn't it?
I know. I've got time until 3. It's just after 12.
All right.
So, but it's up to you. So you are the guest.
I don't know. Do you have more questions? Look like you have a lot of questions. Okay. Look like you have a lot of questions. Okay.
No, like when we find a brother who has knowledge and who is willing to share, we are here to learn, we are here to make use of it.
Well, I'm happy to share, and you know, for me, I do my best, and all of us, we are a student in this life, and we learn. Learning is a process, never end, and the one who think that he knows everything, he's a fool. So but we as a Christians been ordered in the Bible to read the books, and we have to be anti-ignorance. Ignorance is our enemy. That's what the Bible says. So, and we are not against Muslims, by the way. For me, I feel for them. I care for them. And actually, this is why we are here, trying to save them.
It is the Islam which is dangerous for mankind, not the Muslims.
Yeah, we are, you know, even Jesus himself, he said, I came for the sick, not for the healthy, you know. So we as a Christians, we should always care for the Muslims and don't think about them as enemies. I know that Muslims believe in us as enemies, but we should not go down to their level, because that will make Shaitan or Satan the winner. If I take the Muslim as an enemy, and the Muslim already taking me as an enemy, who is the only winner here? Satan. And then we start killing each other. So we as a Christians, we should not allow hate. We should not allow violence. And we are talking against Islam. We are not talking about against Muslims. Muslims are victims of a cult, and they need our help. So when somebody have an injury, be Christian and help him. That's what Christianity is about. You don't make fun of the injured. You help him. And here we are not here to make fun of a person. We are not talking about a person. We are talking about a religion. We are making fun of the devil himself, who tried to fool people, make them believe in stupid things. So our enemy is the devil. And if you are a Muslim and you are listening, you should join me, not to be against me. And if you are wrong, show us that we are wrong. But don't take the order of the devil and use violence. Because trust me, the second you are a violent person, you are not serving God. And this is how you should know that your God cannot be God. You see, if a Muslim, he have really a religion, and he have a God, what kind of God he says, kill them, Allah, he punished them by your hands. What about you say to your God? You punish them. What about you, Allah? You punish them. Aren't you God? What kind of God he need a poor person to go and die for him? Can't he do it? Why he want you to die for him? The God of the Christians, look at the different Christianity. God of Christians, he gave himself to save us. God of Islam, he wants you to die for him to save him. So if you are the one who can protect your God, how weak is your God? If your sword is the one who will protect Allah, what kind of Allah you have? God do not need my sword to protect him. When the soldiers, they came to arrest Jesus, Peter, he took his sword and he cut the ear of one of the soldiers. And Jesus, he ordered Peter to put his sword back, and he healed the soldier. That is God, my friend. He do not need the protection of anyone. Even though he knew they are going to take him and crucify him, and he will be killed in the cross, but yet because he knew that death cannot take him, he overcome death. But yet he will not let you go and die for him, so you will save him if he is God. So if you believe that Allah is God, the first question you should ask yourself, why your God is disabled? He cannot protect himself. Why he need mujahideen? Why he cannot spread Islam without a sword? What about sending messengers to teach the words? Why Muhammad is the last messenger? Why? I mean, that's it. Islam is all over the world. A man, he can spread. How that can happen? It's a silly, it's a stupid. Muhammad, he claimed he is the last messenger in order to cut the business of a prophethood, as he did, as a scam. So he said, I am the last one. He don't want anyone to come after him and to replace him in the business. It's a business mentality. I am the last vendor. No vendor after me. Why there is no prophet after him? Is the people are guided? No. People are lost today. People are lost tomorrow. And people will be lost even at the judgment day. There's people who they are guided. There's people they will be lost. So why there's no messenger after me? And not only that, just to show you how silly Muhammad is. He have a very bad lack of intellect and intelligence. The Quran says that Allah, he never sent any messenger unless he speak the tongue of his people so they might understand. Chapter 14, verse number 4. Was Muhammad a messenger to the Indian? The Muslim, they say yes. But do Muhammad understand and speak all the languages of the Indians? The answer is no. There's hundreds of languages in India. And not only that, he have to be one of them, not only speak the language. Was Allah, did Allah send Muhammad to the German? Muslims, they say yes. He is a messenger for all mankind. But Allah in the Quran said, we never send a messenger except to teach in the language of his own people. In order what? In order to make it clear for them. So the logic in front of you, this is the logic of Allah, not my logic. You cannot have it clear unless the messenger, he speak your language. And this is your Quran. So how Muhammad is a messenger to the Chinese, the Indian, the Japanese, the Russian, even Arab, they cannot understand the Quran. To the point, even Muhammad, he asked Allah to send him seven Qurans. Seven Qurans to a village in the size of Mecca. If the people of Mecca who speak the Arabic, they cannot understand the Quran unless they have it in seven Quran. How a person like Zakir Naik, he understand the Quran? Brother Thitter, it's very clear that in Islam we have no women to the Prophet. And the reason for that, because Allah is do. I mean, this guy, he is going to teach you Islam. If the Muslim scholars who speak Arabic, they say Allah knows best what he meant. Even those who speak Arabic, they are born. I am an Arab. Arabic is my first language. And I suffer strongly to understand what this stupid Quran is saying. So how a guy like Zakir Naik, he can explain the Quran for you? Ahmed Bidat, he don't speak Arabic. Zakir Naik, he don't speak Arabic. Shabir Ali don't speak Arabic. But yet, they want to explain the Quran for us. And the Quran saying that in order to understand, you have to know the language. The Prophet himself, he have to speak the language of you, not you speaking his language only. So how that can, and not only that, additional to this, even the Quran, because Muhammad is a thief. In his time, he could not explain the Quran. So Muhammad, he said to them, oh, hold on, hold on. Don't ask me questions. There's many verses and a lot of things in the Quran. Nobody knows what they mean. Save Allah, brother. What? The Prophet himself do not know how to explain the Quran. Chapter 3, verse number 7. So the Quran have two parts. One is so clear and one so unclear. And nobody knows the meaning of it save Allah. Have you ever heard of a stupid cult like this? So why you are sending me those verses and those chapters if nobody knows what they mean save Allah? Nobody knows the meaning save Allah. Okay, so Muhammad do not know too. Have you ever heard of a prophet? He do not know what the meaning of his prophecy. He do not know what is the meaning of the word he is saying. That is Muhammad. Why? Because he is a thief and he cannot explain things he said. So the only answer is, don't ask me, ask Allah. Nobody knows what they mean.
Yet Islam is supposed to be very simple.
Yeah. Anything else?
No, I'm just very disappointed on Islam, and I'm very disappointed on Muslims.
No, the Muslims are getting improved. Actually, a lot of Muslims are leaving Islam. You know, if you see, you know, in my Skype, how many Muslims they text me, they are out of Islam. It's actually the news is really great. I mean, they are really leaving Islam left and right, and you know, the internet is a disaster for Islam. The Muslims, they invested a lot of money in the internet, in YouTube. They make tons of thousands of movies and videos like science and Quran and etc. blah 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 blah. But it's still, because it's fabricated, not only did not help, it destroyed them. Because sooner or later people will find out that this was nothing but a false claim. And then what will happen is the same as the shepherd. He used to keep saying, a wolf, a wolf. First time they come to him. Second time they come to him. Third time, nobody believe him no more. So the Muslims, They claim that they have a wolf. First time, people believe them. This is in the beginning when the oil start coming. Second time, people believe them. This is before we appear. Third time, people did notice that this is, was nothing but a lie. And now all the videos which the Muslims they make about science in the Quran, it turn against them. Because if Islam is a decent religion, why Muslims cannot be decent and say the truth about what is written in the Quran? Why they fabricate scientific miracles when it is the opposite? The only answer is the father of all lies is Satan. And those who do lies, the lies of Satan, they are following Satan, not God. So if you are a Muslim and you fabricate a video claiming that there is a science in the Quran, you should know first, not me, that obviously you are following Satan. Because the first question you should ask yourself, why I'm lying to make my God look right? If my God is God, you know what I mean, guys? Why I need to lie to make my God look good? Why God cannot make it good? He's God. So what kind of God he need my lies to be promoted?
Ines, let me know when you want to go.
Well, I think we have enough for today. We have a lot. We have a lot of information, isn't it enough for today? I mean,
you got awesome. And by the way,
if you want, you can take the video from my channel, so you can have two videos, because now maybe people did not read clearly in your screen, so you can download the video and post it in your channel too.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Sorry, in my culture, I can't just kick out the guests. So you need to tell me when you want to go.
Oh, well, I'm going to go, and I will let you. Will let you with your friends if you want to continue talking with them. But I'm so glad, sister, that I spoke to you. I saw your videos many times, and I encourage you, and we support you and all the team you work with. They are wonderful, and you are wonderful too. And I hope people will support your channel. Actually, I put a video, a link, guys. I put a link under my video for our sister and their team. She don't work alone. She have what is the name of the the team with you?
DCCI Ministries, Defend Christ, Critic Islam.
But who is the guys who work with you?
So I've got brother called Daniel, brother called Godwin, and we do have a brother called King. We've got like lots of people who are also behind the cameras
Well, God bless them, and I encourage all the people to support that channel. And as you see, the link is under my video. So if you like, you can click and you can subscribe. And guys, subscribing doesn't cost you money. Those people they need and they deserve your support. They go, they stand, and they fight for the truth. So they are not fighting for themselves. They are fighting for the truth. They are working, they are serving, and they are doing the good work, which many people don't do because they are lazy. So if those people, you don't support them, you will support who?
So before you go.
Yes.
So it took lots of time for me to harass you and have you here. And we noticed that you are a man, as a Christian man who keeps his promises. Can we have you back?
I don't promise.
Why not?
I don't promise, but you are welcome. You are welcome to call me anytime. I am on air, and you can ask me the questions you want.
But you can't say that, because once I got message, one of the Muslim from speakers gonna wear in your show.
Okay.
And I came to listen, and I was gonna call you, like maybe a minute before you simply said, Christians don't call me, so I couldn't call you.
No. You see, there is people who they are like, they consider them as missionaries. Then they can call, but you can text me and say, can I call? And then I will say, yes, call me, no problem. Even if, because sometimes people they call me when it's a wrong time, you know. So, and you know, most of the time I want to talk to Muslims, but now we change the way we are doing things, because we don't want just the kids to call us. We want someone who claim to be professional, sheikh, scholar, to call me. So text me if I am live on air and ask, can I call? and I will answer you, says either yes or no.
Thank you.
All right.
And let me express once again, I am very grateful that after harassing you for a long time, you were able to share some of the informations you have. I am sure that was only 0.0001, but maybe not even 0.0001, but I am sure we will make use of it. And I am sure by God's grace, we will use it for the kingdom.
Amen to that.
And can I encourage also you to do like volume 3-4 of Allah and Sex? It is very good material for Muslims, and it is helpful for Christians to rescue Muslims from Islam.
Well, I'm working now in 3 books at the same time, so we will see. You know, I mean, when I have time, I will, you know, we will see. Because if I want to make a volume number 3, then I have to make volume number 4, because sex in Islam is like cannot be covered by a million volume. The whole religion is about sex. So there, I made it what is enough to prove a point.
Yeah.
And there's tons of reference. I mean, my books is not really just a book. It's a library of reference. Everything is there, nothing of my own. And I make it in a very simple way to understand.
Oh, well, it doesn't, in that case, it doesn't have to be volume 3 or 4. Anything you write there, I am sure you write up, I am sure it will be useful for the kingdom.
I'm doing my best, sister. Thank you very much.
And once again, thanks for joining us. May Lord bless you and keep you safe and give you a little bit more compassionate for Christians mainly. You are handling Muslims well, but for Christians. And I'll be in touch with you through probably Skype.
All right, sister. Take care and say hello and God bless to all your team with you.
Thank you.
Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. All right, guys. Great people. And please don't forget to subscribe to their channel, support them. I left the link for you there under the video. They deserve your support. Always when you see someone doing a good work, just do what is right, you know. Do what is right. I think we are done for today. Anything else? Anything else? Yeah. You know, like, what I don't like about us as a Christians, if a Muslim doing what those guys doing, you will find that in less than 10 days, he will have 10,000 subscribers. But when a Christian, he do that, his subscriptions goes like maybe 5 a day, 2, 3. I mean, why? What we will lose? Like, I mean, nobody's asking you to pay them money. You just subscribe, support them, post a comment, give a like to their video. They are doing a great job. So you as a Christian, you should not, I mean, you do not need somebody to tell you what to do. You should be always able to do the right thing. What is this guy calling me? Don't call me without permission, otherwise I will block you. All right? Let us see here. Yeah. Anyway, if you know a Muslim who is a scholar or somebody he claimed to be a big shot, and a big shot mean somebody he debates, somebody he's, you know, is very well known, maybe in YouTube and Facebook, that he want to bring people to Islam, he is more than welcome to challenge me anytime, even without a date. All what you need to do, he posts in his Facebook, and don't give me and don't send me link of Facebook of a kid he posts in Facebook, I want to debate a Christian prince. The admins in the chat, they are not listening. When I say post in your Facebook and we will verify who you are, we are talking about verifying that he is someone qualified to talk to me, not a kid. All right, we have enough of kids. So when somebody want to debate me, there's two things we need to check out. The reason we say Facebook, if he is in a Facebook, he will have tens of thousands of people following him, debate videos, etc. Then okay, post there, he want to debate me, post your link for us, I check it out, you are legitimate, you are real, and you really you know your religion, then you are welcome. But a kid, he made a Facebook page. Who is this guy? Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Yes?
Hello?
Yes, how can I help you?
Hello, Christian Prince.
Yes, my friend, how I can help you?
I am from Indonesia. My name is Aditya.
Okay. You are live on air. What do you want to say to us, my friend?
I always watch your video, and I'm say thank you for your from your video.
All right. I'm happy you like them, and I'm happy to see people from Indonesia learning from them.
Yes. But I may have requests for you.
All right.
Can you make video about the Messiah in Old Testament?
The Messiah in the Old Testament.
Al-Masih.
Okay. In the Old Testament. All right.
Yes, it's for Jews, because we know Jews don't believe Al-Masih.
No, you are wrong. The Jews, they believe in the Messiah. Who say they don't? The Jews today, they are the few who left. They did not believe, but the majority of the Jews already, they became Christians. You know, isn't it all the apostles of Jesus are Jews? Right?
Yes.
All the apostles of Jesus. No. So it's wrong to say the Jews don't believe. Those are the one that left. They are the minority. The majority already, they became a Christian. This is why after 2,000 years after Jesus, still we have less than maybe 25, 30 million Jews. Why? Because the majority, they became a Christians. So people wrongly think the Jews still do not believe in Jesus. Those are the minority. Few of them don't. All right? And not only that, actually, they are coming to Christ. I mean, I predict that Israel, in 30, 40 years from now, the majority will become a Christian nation. It's not going to be a Jewish nation no more.
Okay. All
right. Yeah. Anyway, I will explain maybe in the coming video when I go live on air about things in the Old Testament about Jesus. No problem.
Yes, thank you. Because I have a Jewish friend, and they not believe Jesus is Al-Masih.
Hmm. Yeah, he's a Jewish from where? From Indonesia.
Yes, in North Sulawesi. I'm Christian, and why you not believe Jesus is Al-Masih?
Yeah, my friend, he is not a Jew. Those are people, he's an Asian person, right?
Yes.
Okay, how an Asian can be a Jew? I mean, this guy is being silly now, because a Jew is not just a religion. The Jews are two things in the same time. It is an ethnic and religion in the same time. So to be a Jew, to be a Jew, the word Jew actually is about being from a tribe. So how this guy is an Asian, and I saw that in the Philippines too. Somebody, he think he's a Jew. I mean, they are fooling you and making you believe not that you are a Jew. You are not a Jew, and you cannot be a Jew. A Jew is somebody is born of a mother. She is a Jewish woman, and she is from the tribes of the children of Abraham. So how somebody is from Asia, he convinced himself he's a Jew. He's being silly. So what about he debate himself first about how he became a Jew and he's an Asian? Can you become a Jew? Can I convert to Judaism? You cannot. Judaism is not a convert religion. You cannot convert to be a Jew. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah. So yes, I know.
This guy, before he's trying to debate you about the Messiah, ask him how you became a Jew. You are an Asian. He must be very silly, and he is suffering from lack of knowledge. Ask him, do you know even what a Jew mean? What a Jew mean? Is that somebody just believe in Moses? No. To be a Jew, you have to be from the nation of the Jews. You have to be from the Hebrew. You have to be from the people who crossed the sea. You have to be from the children of Isaac. Are you from the children of Isaac? Isaac is a Middle Eastern. Are you? You know what I mean?
Yes, yes. Like now, Isaac is Middle East.
To be a Christian, you can be an Asian. You can be black. You can be an Indian. You can be. But you cannot be a Jew and yet you're an Asian. It's obvious. It's a lie.
Yes, Christian Prince, but okay. I just want answer from the Jews.
No problem.
And see, the Jews, they always rejected Christian belief.
No problem. No, just what I'm saying to you, the Jews don't really reject the Christian belief. The majority of them, they are Christians, and they call themselves Messianic Jews. Messianic Jews.
Yes.
There's a lot of, most of the Jews already are Christians. All the apostles of Jesus, they are Jews. So wrongly people think that the Jews rejected Jesus. It's not true. The fact, we, including me and you, we learned about Jesus from the Jews. It is the Jews who taught us about Jesus.
Yes, from Al-Hawariyun.
No, this is a stupid name in the Quran. We don't believe in it. Yeah. Anything else, my friend?
No.
Yeah. And next time, before you call me, please ask me if you can call. Don't just call me right away, because sometimes it might disturb my topic. Just ask me before you call, so I will let you.
I'm sorry, Christian Prince.
No problem, my friend. Take care and say hello to all the people of Indonesia, and I love you all. All right?
Okay, thank you.
Okay, take care. Anyone can convert to Judaism and become a Jew? No, that's not true. You cannot. You cannot. You know, you cannot. Those are the children of Israel, and they are called that because they are the children of Israel, not because they are the followers of Israel. You know what I mean, guys? Even the Quran, even your silly book, call the Jews the children of Israel. That means they have a lineage. They have a lineage. Hey, Rafael, so what if you are a Jew? My friend, are you a convert Jew? Because Jews today, they are outnumbered, and Judaism is dying, so they are accepting anyone to convert. I saw some people trying to convert people to Judaism in New York. But this is now. This is fake. This is false. You cannot. Can you show me the verses as long as you claim to be a Jew, can you show me the verses in the Old Testament it says that you can convert people to Judaism? What do you say? Jesus had a Gentile woman in his lineage. Here we go. Let me show you how silly you are. Guys, is it true that Moses, he did marry a woman, she is not from the children of Israel? Just to show you how stupid those who claim to be Jews in front of us here. Is it true that Moses, he did marry a woman, she is not from the children of Israel, and he have a children from her? Yes or no? So, based on your talk, all the children of Moses are not Jews. Right? To be a Jew, you have to confirm your lineage in the blood, either from the mother or the father. Secondly, Jesus, we don't believe that Jesus is the son of any man. That's why we are Christians. And I will let Jesus himself answer you. Isn't it Jesus said to the Pharisees, people like you, you claim to be a Jew, what do you say of the Messiah? What do you say of Christ? They said he is a son of David. Right, he said. Well, if he is the son of David, then how David called him Jehovah? And this is in the Old Testament. How David called him? How the Jews call David, he called the Messiah Jehovah. So obviously, you don't even know what is written in your book. And when you debated, or your grandfather, if you are claiming to be who you are, they have an argument with Jesus, they could not answer him. How you say he is a son of David? Yet, David called him my God. So I find that those who claim to be people of, or they claim to speak of knowledge, they have no knowledge, sadly. And I don't believe you are a Jew. What about you give me a call? You want to call me? Do you like to call me, my friend? Do you like to call me, Mr. Jew? I want to see how much Jew you are. I want to learn from you about Judaism. You are what? In YT? What does that mean? What does that mean? Okay. Yeah, obviously you are a fake Jew. There's a guy, he claimed to be a Jew, rabbi. He called himself to Weaver Singer. Go and see how I got him busted so easy. You don't play with us. And I will not be surprised if you are a Muslim yourself. But anyway, what you are saying to me is a silly. Jesus said, I am from above. My kingdom is not in this earth. You are from down this earth. I am from above. And the Old Testament confirmed that David called the Messiah Jehovah. So how he is Jehovah, called by David, yet he is from a lineage of, as you say, the women who is Gentile. That does not, still he is Jehovah. And Jesus is born of a virgin. Now, some of the Jews, they say the Messiah, or the prophecy about Christ, that he will be born, he is not going to be born of a virgin. The Bible, the Old Testament says that he will be born of a young woman. And here you will see how silly those who claim to be Jews are. Anyone knows why? Anyone knows why? You know, sometimes the Jews are no better than the Muslims when they come to be silly. When they say to us that the word there is young, not virgin, not only they are proving to us they are silly, proving to us that they are stupid. Because it says there that this will be a sign, a miracle. So if a young give birth, every day there's young giving birth. So every day there's a Christ is born. You know what I mean? So in order for that, in Isaiah chapter 7, to be considered a young, that means you have to have a younger brain of a stupid person. Because that how that can be a miracle, how that can be a sign of God, if it is just about a woman, she is young giving birth. Do you know how many young women they give birth every day? So how that can be about being young? So the verses there is very clear. This is a sign. It's a miracle, which means something never happened before. Not something happened every day. Let us read the verse together just to show you how silly those who call themselves Jews. Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Do you see a sign, guys? Do you know what sign mean? What sign mean? It's a miracle, right? It's something never happened. A sign. If we change here the translation to the way the Jews they try to make it, they say it's not doesn't say virgin, a young. Where is the sign if a young she conceive a son? There's no sign there no more. Because young women, actually they are a woman. Today they consider them children. Actually, if you are like 13 and you have your period, if you have 12. Even some of them, they might be like, you know, like 12, depend in the child, I mean the person. So if she have her period, she have sex, she will have a child. So where is the sign here? Where is the miracle? The verse confirm that this is a miracle, a miraculous birth. And the only way for it to be miraculous, if it's a virgin, not if it's a young. Any young woman, she can give birth. Why not? I mean, what is the miracle? Actually, if a woman, she can give birth in young age, that means she will never give you birth after. That is not a sign. And this is how we see how silly they are. They are desperately trying to disapprove Jesus. The same as Muhammad trying to disapprove Jesus to be who he is. Both of them, they work in the same direction, but they are losing ground. And today, because the Jews, they are shrinking in number so fast. While Christianity is growing, Judaism is almost gone. This is why I find that Jews are so angry from the Christians. Why? Because the Jews, they convert to Christianity, not to Hinduism, not to Buddhism, not to Islam. The Christianity. That's why they're upset. My friend, Cloudy, I do not speak Hebrew, but even if you see that, just to show you the silliness, those all the Christians who speak Hebrew, including the apostle of Jesus who speak Hebrew, including Jesus who debated about that, he don't speak Hebrew too? In the time of Jesus, the Jews could not refute Jesus. So if you think you are the only one who speak Hebrew, you are mistaken. Same time I went with you. I am going with you. Let us change this word here from a virgin to young. Still, that will make the verse silly. Will make the verse out of meaning. God will give you a sign and the young woman will give birth. If you respect God, then you respect that this is a miracle. This is what the verse is saying. And there is no way it is a miracle because a young woman she gave. She is a woman anyway. Right? Those who they claim that the translation is wrong, they say young woman. She is a woman. So what is the miracle of a woman? She gave birth and she is young. That's not a miracle. She is a woman already. You know what I mean? This is why I find that I sometimes I feel sorry for those people who argue, because I find that they have a low IQ, they have a lack of intellect. A young woman, she will give birth. Okay, my grandmother, she gave birth when she was young, very young. She was, I think, 90. My friend, anyway, don't tell me I understand your understanding. I believe if you have a knowledge, then you should be able even to talk to the Messiah, and you have to be able to refute him. I saw many rabbis making videos against Christianity, and they made me a better believer because I found them, they are lying and they are deceiving people. As an example, I saw a rabbi, or he claimed to be a rabbi, he says the word echad does not mean anything except one. But the Bible says that the man and the women, they get married and they became echad. And this is exactly the same word we have in Arabic. And here you see that they claim to be a rabbi, but they don't respect themselves. Be honest. I mean, how people respect you? You are a rabbi. Simply, it's a business. And they are defending Islam, by the way, speaking against Christianity. They will not dare to speak against Islam. So those rabbis are satanic. They are not Jews. The real Jews will not do that. A real Jew, rabbi or not rabbi, he will not lie, fabricate the translation. He will not lie and say echad does not mean one as unification. He will say it as it is. And I have videos about this guy. Go and see how many videos I get him busted with. And the coward, he will never dare to call me or to debate me or even let me call him. All right? My friend, Rafael, it's not about you speaking against Christian or not. You said you can be a Jew convert. That is not a true. All the Old Testament speaking about the tribes of Israel. Do you have a tribe which is not from Israel? Is that correct, guys? Who is the one who is blessed? The nation of Israel, not the religion. The nation of Israel. Who is Israel? Israel, a man, and he have kids. It's not a belief. They have a belief, yes, but the blessed persons are persons. Correct? So why you are being silly? You see, even Abraham, he have children, which is have nothing to do with Israel. As an example, Ishmael, right? Okay. Is Ishmael from Israel? No. Can we say the children of Israel of Ishmael, they are from Israel? No, they are cousins. So we are being silly. Was Jesus a Jew? No, he was not a Jew. I just quote for you what Jesus said. Jesus said, I am the God of the Jews. And even David, he quote that. David, he said, that he is the God of the Jews. He is Jehovah. So how Jesus will be a Jew? He's born between the Jew. He's born from a Jewish woman, but he is the God of the Jews. This is why he says, I came to my people and my people rejected me. But in the same time, he said, my kingdom is from above and you are down from earth. So obviously, obviously you do not even know what Christianity is about, because how you say that Jesus was a Jew if the Christian believe that he is the God of the Jews? Isn't it, guys? Isn't it Jesus says before Abraham I am? Okay, let me ask you, was Abraham a Jew? If he is exists before Abraham, and Abraham, he saw my day. And look at the Jews, because they are silly, they could not understand who is he. They said, how you can be, how you, what do you mean, Abraham, he saw your day and you are not even 50 years old? So he is the God of Abraham, not only the God of the Jews. He exists before Abraham exists. He is the Alpha, he is the Omega. So when you say, was he a Jew? Obviously, you are the same as Muhammad, who think that the Christian, they believe in the Trinity as Mary and Jesus and Allah. Obviously, you don't understand Christianity. Right? But anyway, we welcome all questions, and we welcome those who, you know, they do not know what they are talking about. Eh, it's okay, I understand. You know? I understand. But try, you know, I advise you, try not to be silly. Because sometimes we say things without thinking. Even I saw Christians saying that Jesus is a Jew. And how is a Jew if he is the God of the Jews? How is a Jew yet he before Abraham he is? How is a Jew that everything created by him and for him? That is silly. By birth, he is born from the Jews. But all of us, we knew that his birth is not the beginning of his existence. Is that correct? When he says that Abraham, he witnessed, he saw my day, and before Abraham I am, he is confirming to you that my existence have nothing to do with my birth. So we are smarter than this. Yeah, Raphael, let me tell you why you have in Israel Jews from all nations, because you need population. That is a desperate, let us say, act for a desperate situation. Israel need population, and they need Jews. So there is people who claim to be Jews from the Falasha in Ethiopia. But how they became Jews? Nobody can explain to us. So because you need population, you need the army, you need to defend yourself, you need to establish your state, so you start accepting people, whoever says they are Jews, and they believe they are Jews. It's just for the, let us say, for the benefit of surviving. But if you go in Israel, you will see that the rabbis, they don't accept those Jews as Jews in reality. But because they need them, they say, okay, come over. You know what I mean? Because they need them. No, Jesus is not. You know what a Jew mean? Like, look, those people do not understand what Jews mean. What a Jew mean? This guy, Georgian, he says, Jesus is a Jew because of his human nature. So if it, because of a human nature, that would make you a Jew, that would be strange, because the human nature of Jesus is exist before his birth. When Jesus says before Abraham, and Abraham he saw my day, isn't it Jesus speaking about God? He came to Abraham as a man. Is that correct, guys? People, is that correct? How Abraham he saw my day? God, he came to Abraham as a man. So the nature of man, God, is exist before his birth. He came as a man. So you're being silly. Before the Jews are exist, he came as a man. But people don't want to use their mind, what I can say. All right? Jesus image from not from David? No, not from David. Why people don't read? I just said, Jesus said to the Jews, what do you say of the Messiah? He said he is a son of David. He said, well, if he is a son of David, then how David call him my Jehovah? I mean, what's wrong with people? Unbelievable. If he is a son of, this is Jesus talking, not the Christian prince. Who is the one who's talking? Jesus. What he's saying, listen carefully. You see, stop being silly. And I have no, I have patience, but I am not the Lord himself. This is John chapter 8. And this is the Bible in Aramaic, translated in plain English. Read carefully what Jesus says to the Jews, so you might understand, even if you are slow. He said, who? The Messiah, not the Christian prince. The Messiah, not Christian prince. Let us read together and see what the Bible says. You know, sometimes really I find it funny how people they talk, and obviously they are not reading the Bible. You can read John chapter 8, because I believe this is very important chapter too, in order to understand the Messiah. Let us see. All of this conversation, by the way, is between Jesus and the Jews. All right? He is not debating with the Abdul. He is debating with the Jews. They said to him, the Jews, they said, saying to him, now we know that a demon is in you. Abraham is dead and the prophet, and you are saying, whoever keeps my words shall never taste death. What do you mean? He never tastes death? Anyone follow your word, he will never taste death? Because they are silly, like many here. They think he is talking about that if you hear his words, you don't die. You know, this is what he's saying. He promised you eternity. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who died? And the prophet who died, who are you making yourself? Yeshua, he answered, saying, if I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me. He of whom you say, he is our God. And you do not know him, but I know him. If I had said that, I do not know him, I myself have been liar to like you, but I do know him, and I keep his words. Abraham, your father, desired to see my day, and he saw it and rejoiced. And the Jews were saying to him, you are not 50 years old, and you have seen Abraham? Yeshua said, timeless truth, I speak to you, before Abraham would exist, I am the living God. My friend, Jesus is the living God. So how you say the living God is Jew? That because you are silly and you are limited in your thinking. You forgot that the whole idea of Jesus being born between the Jews is to save the Jews, not to be a Jew. He exists before the Jews. He is the one who created the Jews. So you became so limited like a child when you say Jesus is a Jew. He is the Alpha, he is the Omega. But anyway, everybody, you know, he have his limitation, and I understand. I'm not going to change you. I do my best to help you. It been said to you, Jesus said, but I say to you. Jesus, when he speak, when he say, it been said to you, but I say to you, he was talking about what? Who is he? It been said to you, but I say to you. Which authority he have? Authority of a prophet or authority of God? You know what I mean, guys? Authority of God. All the teaching of Jesus speaking about himself as God, and yet you say to me, Jesus is a Jew. That's because you are silly. You are just a child in the faith of God. I advise you to read your book carefully. (Clears throat) All right. Are we done for today, guys? Are we good for today? Did we have a good time? We have a good time, right? Anyway, I want to say thank you for everybody, and I hope that's we do our best to share our education. And for me myself, I don't claim to be a person who knows everything. I'm just a student, and I will be learning until the last day of my life. And as I said, the one who thinks he knew everything, he is a fool. That is impossible. But to be a Christian is to understand what to be a Christian. I mean, it's silly to be a Christian, but yet you do not know who's a Christ. Christ is our God. He is not a Jew. He is the God of the Jews. Everything was created by him and for him. I mean to that. So when you read the Bible, I advise you not to read it like you are reading a story. And this is the problem, you know. Even when you read the Quran, people, they read it like, okay, but nobody wanna go deep. Especially in the Bible, the words is so deep. Actually, one of the unique things about the Bible is, I can read this chapter tomorrow, and still I will inspire something in you by reading it, even though it is the same chapter written 2,000 years ago. Because this is the living word of God. It is inspiration. It's talk to your heart. It's not just talking to your brain. So in order to understand it, you have to live it. You have to be a person who bring a spirit of God with him, not only a silly reading, which means nothing. So every one of us, maybe you speak better Arab English than me, but doesn't mean that you understand the Bible better than me, even in English. Because simply, if you decide just to read the words, not to be inspired by the words, and not to go deep behind the words, you are the same as the Jews. When he said to them, whoever hear my words, he will live. They thought he's talking about they will live now, they will never die. You are just being silly like the Jews. When the Jews, they said, when he said, Abraham, he saw my day, they are looking at the man, how this man, he is not even 50 years old, and yet he is saying that Abraham saw my day. Obviously, they don't understand who is he. But I understand that Jews, they have that problem because they are exploring Christ at that moment. But you, who've been taught already who is a Christ, so it's not a surprise for you to know who is he, yet you claim what you claim. You know what I mean? How he can be named the Son of Man if he is the one? The Son of Man is a title, which means that he is in the flesh, as simple as that. The Son of Man is a translation from the Hebrew, where it is the son of the flesh. Adam, by the way, the word Adam is not even a man. Even Eve was called Adam, right? Correct? In the beginning of the Old Testament, Adam and Eve were called Adam. So Adam is the human. Not necessarily, but later it became the name of the man. But the son of the human. Why? Because he is God in the flesh. But he is not a man. Which means he is not, you know, he is the perfectly, in the same time he is man, but yet he is God. But he is not a man, the same as all of us. So God in the flesh is the son of a man, which means the son of a human. But all of us, we knew that Jesus is a son of no human. So that is a title to describe the nature of the body, not the nature of God. So he's a perfect man and God in the same time. And this is why I say sometimes people, they are, you know, they say, okay, Jesus said the son of man, but the Christian believe that Jesus even born of no man. Mary is the Virgin Mary. So what man we are talking about? That is just the nature of the birth. All right. So in order to understand Christianity, I advise you, if you are confused about certain things, you know, search them, study them carefully, and you will find that it's not what you think they meant. Otherwise, you will be confused the same as the Jews in the beginning, who they don't understand what Jesus is talking about. Whoever believe, whoever heard my words, he will live. He will not taste death. This is why they said to him, after he said that, are you greater than our father Abraham, who died, and the prophet who died? Which means, if the prophet died, how you say to us, if we listen to you, we will not die? That because they have a limited interpretation for the sentence. So you can be the same as the Jews. And many of us today is the same as those Jews. They decide to go blind and they don't want to see what is behind the words. They think he's talking about death now, and okay, you listen to me, you will not die. But this is obviously not what Jesus meant. So either you use your mind and your brain and live the words, or you know, you decide to be a fool and you don't want to be understanding anything. All right. Anyway, now the Bible can go deeper and deeper and deeper and study, but I believe that the beautiful thing about the Bible, I can be a farmer who hardly knows how to read and how to write, and yet I enjoy the wisdom and the glory of God. You see, this is a book for everybody, not like the Quran. You need to be a genius in Arabic, a person who have to speak many languages, because the Quran is stealing words from everywhere. And then you have to connect the dots, and then verses are scattered everywhere, and sometimes there's no meaning because Muhammad is trying to make Arabic music, and then you have to work hard to put them together. The Bible is a lot more simple, to the point it is a book of wisdom, because God is not the author of confusion. So what make it a miracle, it is simple. To the point, a person who is a farmer, he can listen to the gospel and he can enjoy it. A person who have a PhD, he can read and he can explore it and he can enjoy it. So both can be a believers. And each time you read it, sometime even you might find yourself in the story. If you are a person really trying to be living the story, not only reading the story. So the Bible speaks to you, and the Bible encourages you to live with the word, not just to read the words. And this is really what I like about the Bible. But sadly, my topic is about the cult of Islam, so we don't talk much about the teaching of Christ. Otherwise, there's no better joy than enjoying the wisdom here you see in front of you. Go and read any speech, Christ, he said, and you tell me, what do you see? It's so beautiful, it's so amazing. And always, if you are a person, I remember, this is a story about a child. There is people, they invited a family, Arabian family, to a big dinner. I mean, those people, they slaughter a big animal, the table is so long, so big, and etc. I mean, yeah, they put everything you can imagine in the table, fruits, anything. And then the kid of the guest family, he looked at the whole table, he said, there's no hummus. You know what I mean? So the kid, he is unhappy because there is no hummus. The people, they slaughter a big animal, the barbecue, the fruits, the drink, even they have maids around the table. But the kid, where is my hummus? I love hummus. He's a kid. And sometimes we are like that kid who only see in the whole table the hummus. That's because you are looking for the hummus. You know what I mean? So if you are a person looking for what is wrong, because you don't like it anyway. I mean, I'm going to try to find something wrong there. It doesn't matter what you do to me. It doesn't matter how good it is. What is my hummus? No hummus, you did nothing. So are you getting my point, guys? Are you getting my point I'm trying to say to you? So if we are people looking for what is enjoyable, it's amazing there. If you are looking for the hummus, well, good for you. Anyway, guys, and don't take me wrong, I like hummus. So anyway, thank you very much, guys, for being here. And again, if you like to learn more about the cult of Islam, feel free to read my books. And you can search in Amazon. We have them in many languages: English, French, Dutch, Swedish, Spanish, and what else? And soon Portuguese, by the way. So you know, I hope that people, they will learn. And education is a gift from God, and it is the best thing a human being can enjoy. You know, you can enjoy food for 5 minutes, you can enjoy even sex for some time, but education live with you and grow with you and will change your life, will change your nature, will change your thinking, will change your habit, either for bad or good. So you better choose good education. And with this, I say to you, thank you very much for being here. May the Lord bless you all, and I will see you soon again. Christ is Lord, Islam is false, and thank you.